Meeting of the City of Adelaide on Tuesday, 14th of March 2017. The Deputy Lord Mayor is in the chair. The Council public meeting will be streamed live and recorded for publishing to the internet. Please note that an audio and visual recording is being taken of this meeting. This means that your presence at and any contribution you make to the meeting may be collected, used, disclosed, or published publicly by the Council, including transferring outside of Australia. The red light to my right indicates that the meeting is being filmed and streamed.
Council acknowledges that we're meeting on the traditional country of the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains and pay respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land. We acknowledge they are of continuing importance to the Kaurna people living today. Council also acknowledges the vision of Colonel William Light in determining the site for Adelaide and the design of the city with its six squares and surrounding belt of continuing parklands, which is recognised on the National Heritage List as one of the greatest examples of Australia's planning heritage. Members, I have apologies from Councillor Abiad and from the Lord Mayor. Are there any other apologies? No, there being no other apologies. Can I move to the confirmation of the minutes? We need to confirm the minutes of both the meeting on the 28th of February and the special meeting on the 7th of March. Moved by Councillor Martin, both. Can we do both together? Yes, moved both of them. Seconded by Councillor Clarahan. Any discussion on the minutes? If not, can I put that? All those in favour? That's carried. As I understand it, we have no public forums or deputations, which means we can move to item six of the agenda, and in particular item 6.1, Census of Land Use and Employment 2016 Summary Report. Is someone prepared to move by Councillor Martin? And can I have a seconder? Seconded by Councillor Vershaw. Councillor Martin, you have the floor.
I'm moving as printed, but I do have a question. I thank the administration for the report, but there are no comparisons. And I wonder whether this shows the study, as another presented to Council recently, that employment in the city as a whole is falling. Is that correct?
Through you, Deputy Lord Mayor, yes, it is correct. Employment by businesses in the city, so what the Census of Land Use and Employment collects is the number of people employed by city-based businesses. And that number has fallen from 2014 to 2016, that's correct.
So 115, I think, is the figure for this year. What was the previous figure?
About 122.
Wow, okay, thank you.
Any other questions or comments? It's just to note, so can I put that? All those in favour? That's carried. Brings us to 6.2, Adelaide High School Governing Council. Can I have a mover for that item, please? Or not? Councillor Vershaw, moving it, and seconded by Councillor Moran. Any discussion? We can put this first of all, and then we can move to a nomination. So anyone want to discuss this, or can we move straight to that? No? Okay, so.
Just a question. It doesn't have to be an elected member. It could be a member of the administration. It has to be council. It has to be.
No, as I understand it, it can be a member of staff, but we would then need to change the vary the motion, which is the appointment of a council member to represent council. In order to expedite this, can I just get an indication of whether there is a council member who would be willing or who's able or willing to sit on the governing council of the Adelaide High? No? Then Councillor Vershaw, would you, we might...
I'm happy to move an amendment.
or Councillor Vershaw might just want to vary to...
Well, I just move an amendment. You can, if you like it, take it.
Okay, go ahead, Councillor Maloney.
It's that Council elects not to appoint a representative to the Adelaide High School Governing Council.
I'm advised that's a direct negative.
I knew you were going to say that.
Can I suggest something that we change the word to a council member or a member of the staff?
So can I take some advice about that? I mean, I think that's a... Are you content with that as a variation? Okay. And the second is also content with that as a variation. Who seconded it? Councillor Moran? Yep. So can I just put the variation to the chamber? Thanks. All those in favour of the variation.
Can I ask a question first before that?
Yes, certainly, Councillor Maloney.
Councillor, hypothetically, let's say that there was... our council administration is doing administrative work with that organisation. What impact does it have for that particular administration member if it was a staff member?
Through you, Deputy Lord Mayor. Look, I just need to be sure from an administrative point of view that there were no conflicts or potential conflicts. I'll just manage that internally.
Satisfied with that answer, Councillor Maloney, can I put it to the vote for the variation? All those in favour of the variation? So that's varied to include the words or member of council staff after the words council member. So Councillor Vershaw, do you wish to speak to that? Councillor Moran, do you wish to speak to it? So can we put that and then, but can I just get some advice before we do about how then that will be progressed with a member of staff being selected or not?
Kylie Bennett, thanks.
Through the presiding member, so it would be delegated to the CEO. The CEO would then select an appropriate member of staff to attend that meeting, which I understand is a commitment of once a month on a Wednesday evening. So he would determine an appropriate staff member to attend.
Councillor Moran?
Should we further alter it to say, or staff member to be appointed by the CEO, because at the moment this is saying we're choosing
that
staff member.
Councillor Vershaw, you happy with that further variation? Councillor Moran, you're obviously happy with it, given that you've proposed it. Can I put that variation again to the chamber? Is everyone happy with that variation? Thank you. That variation is included, which means I think all we need then to do is to pass this motion as it is, and we can then hand it over to our Chief Executive to take it from here. So does anyone wish to speak to it or ask any further questions before it? Councillor Maloney.
Sorry, I've got a question. I can't see, maybe it's me, but what dictates that we have someone on this council? Quite often we're doing this for historic reasons and there isn't actually any charter that says that we should have a representative.
Through you, Deputy Lord Mayor, I understand it's the charter of the high school itself that demands a council representative to be appointed. I think that's right. So it's their charter, not ours, that demands it.
Okay, members, I think we've got an appropriate motion in front of us. We can leave it with our CE to take it from here. So can I put that, all those in favour? All those against? That motion is carried. Members, that brings us to item 6.3, delegation to China, May 2017. Now, there's sort of a couple of elements to this, but...
I'm happy to move the substantive.
Okay, thank you. The substantive moved by Councillor Maloney, seconded by Councillor Corbell. Councillor Maloney?
I'll reserve my right.
Councillor Corbell?
Just that at what point can we nominate who the second or the other elected member would be that attends?
We deal with the substantive motion first and then I'll call for nominees. Councillor Martin?
Yes, I wish to speak to the substantive, if I may.
Go ahead.
I'd like to propose an amendment, and that is that we delete paragraph 4. That's it.
Just delete paragraph 4. Is there a seconder for the amendment? That fails for want of a seconder, Councillor Martin. Anybody else wish to speak to the substantive? Councillor Martin.
Look, if I'm not able to amend it, then I will speak against it. My view on this is well known. I'm no fan of overseas delegations, and the most recent to Qingdao cost this council some $60,000 for a return which I still can't fathom. In fact, most of that money on the last occasion we voted on China went to the Qingdao Beer Festival, which was described by the advertiser as the beer fizzer, that is the party to which no one came. There was talk that the last trip would bring a huge franchise deal for a takeaway food provider. That I've not heard anything about that. Has anyone else? There was something supposed to come out of that? No. So
I have heard a little about that.
Oh, good. Well, I'd be happy to hear about it, Acting Lord Mayor.
I'll talk to you about it afterwards. I don't know the veracity of what I've heard, but there is some word on the street.
Well, Acting Lord Mayor, let me tell you, there's a word on the street also that this trip that we're proposing here is going to negotiate a sailing festival for the city of Adelaide. And I do think it's of the utmost importance that somebody should tell Qingdao that we are a landlocked council. Forgetting the Torrens, and the Torrens is not entirely an appropriate place for a yacht race. But nevertheless, I am concerned that this motion here, including paragraph 4, proposes to grant a season pass to the Lord Mayor, the Lady Mayoress, and another councillor. That is to say, it is approval for 2017 and it's approval for 2018. Now, I would argue that good governance demands that such trips should be assessed on an annual basis according to the circumstances, not in advance. And so I will not be supporting the season pass for the trip to China. And I might add that I think there is a risk that this will be seen as a bit of a tricky manoeuvre and looked upon fairly poorly by the ratepayers.
Councillor Slammer.
Thank you, Deputy. Just talking in favour of the motion, I may just add a couple of pieces of information. I think the critical one is to consider that there will be a new mayor of Qingdao. We understand that he'll take office in May, just prior to us getting there. And having had conversations with the Lord Mayor beforehand, he said to me that it wasn't necessary for him to go at this point. But given the fact that there will be a new mayor of the city, of our most successful sister city so far, that they hit that relationship off and commence where the last one was left off. So that's just one important point as to why the Lord Mayor should go, certainly this year, but he might not decide to go next year. At least he'll have the invitation on the table to go should he want to. The second thing is in relation to last year and comments around the beer festival. It's important to recognise that last year was a 30-year anniversary. We've moved on. We're in year 31. And last year took a little bit of extra effort to $60,000, which was paid to the Fringe. And a list of Adelaide artists that, one of which was in a coffee shop this morning when you sat there this morning, Councillor, Indigenous artists that travelled over there and, again, part of the Adelaide University now planning to go back again on certain other invites. So the relationship is good. The relationship needs to be supported. And I would certainly support the recommendation from Council on this note.
Thank you, Councillor Simon. Councillor Vershaw.
Thank you. I might lose my voice in the middle of this, but we'll see how we go. I did actually do several delegations, not with council, but to China. My experience has been that you have to meet several times before you can get business happening. That is just how it works with China. And I was able, with another company, to successfully open up quite an extensive touring program with partners over there, and which expanded from one city to five cities within 2 years. So I do understand the necessity. It's also, these delegations are where we are representing ourselves as a capital city, and not necessarily the boundaries of the City of Adelaide, but City of Adelaide as a capital city, and the mayors are regarded in very high esteem. So the mayors in China regard the mayor of the city almost as an equal or even as a higher official than they might some of the state government officials. And so it's very important that the mayor is profiled at these events. And even with the last delegation that I was with as a cultural delegate, it was absolutely evident that they held our Lord Mayor in high esteem, and that the visit was really important to the success of the trade mission. I do support them going. I also would just like to refer to that last paragraph, and I think perhaps the approval needs to be subject to a report to Council on the success of 2017. So I'd like to do an amendment to that fourth paragraph.
I'm happy to accept that as a variation to the... That's
are you happy with that? Yeah.
So let's just get the wording.
So that says approves the Lord Mayor, Lady Mayoress, additional council member, et cetera, et cetera, on the same basis as 2017 mission, subject to a report
and budget
to Council on the success of 2018 and 2017 and budget approval.
So we've captured that. The mover's obviously happy with that. The seconder was Councillor Corbell. Are you content with the variation? Can I put the variation to the chamber, please? All those in favour of the variation? That's incorporated. Councillor Vershaw, do you wish to carry on? You're done.
No, thank you.
Save that voice. Councillor Moran.
I am surprisingly will be voting against this. I've argued from at the beginning that sister cities needed to earn their right to exist, and while this might be our most publicly known sister city, I have yet to see any clear extra dollar in one ratepayer's pocket, I've never seen any, and I've challenged, tormented, and been arrogantly rude to people who have led them over there. Said, show me one thing that does a broad section of our ratepayers any good at all. And I have never, I think Megan, you might have been the last person that took that challenge, I still haven't heard anything. All we seem to have done is led the Royal Croquet Club over there to almost bankruptcy when about 10 people turned up when they were promised a million. I bet they're thrilled with our Qingdao sister city visit. This is clearly a state government job to do sister cities. I have nothing against sister cities, but us to swan off as a little council just because the Chinese mistake our Lord Mayor for being higher than our Premier, wouldn't it be cheaper to send them a quick memo? Hang on, guys, the Premier's the boss. The Lord Mayor's way down the scale. You don't need to deal with him, you need to deal with the Premier. And as for carting along another councillor, well, that hasn't worked very well so far. And the Lady Mayoress, I thought we'd had this discussion that the Lady Mayoress does not go as an official part of the party. And yet here we've got down here. Although she's paying her own way, she's an official part of the party. Now, nothing against the Lady Mayoress, but if you're part of the delegation, we pay for you. Or you don't go, or you just go as the partner of. So this whole motion just is threaded with things that we have decided not to do anymore. So I vote against going, stay here. We took 2 and a bit years to fix up Frome Road. We still haven't fixed it up, but we're doing swimmingly in Qingdao. Who cares? Nobody.
Councillor Corbell.
Thank you. Look, I do support this, and also I second it, but I reserve my right. Just briefly, I've been on one of these delegations and I can attest to how much activity happens. You literally do not sleep from the moment that you touch the ground to the moment that you're leaving. It's one of the hardest, no, it's not parties, it's one of the hardest times that I've worked in my time as an elected member, let alone in my working career. Lack of sleep, and it's simply because of the number of meetings that you're called to. You're attending official meetings, dinners, you're up early in the morning and you're finishing up late in the evening. And a lot of it is to do with building relationship with key partners in Qingdao and supporting the other businesses and the other participants on the delegation. And a lot of them are connections with city businesses. And as an example, I spent a bit of time with Poltony Grammar and the principal of Poltony Grammar. They've set up a sister school relationship. Now, if you say that they haven't received anything from that, I'm happy to put you in touch with the principal, because that is leading on to beneficial experiences for the students, and including intake of international students, which is a benefit to one of our key ratepayers. And in addition to that, there's a winery, Three Kangaroos, which has received an order for 1 million bottles of distribution in Shandong alone. And it is important that key representatives of City Council go. The Lord Mayor and the elected members are keys to opening doors to businesses doing what they need to do in China. Things happen through the doors of business, local government. Things happen through the doors of local government in China. So having the Lord Mayor or an elected member come alongside at a meeting at the appropriate time and helping to facilitate a business deal or just build some relationship is really, really important.
Thank you, Councillor Caldwell. Anybody else wish to speak to this before I hand back to the mover? Councillor Malani.
Thank you. I wasn't going to speak, but just I think what's really important here is this is not just about sending three people to China. This is about building a longer term relationship with a sort of our sister cities and the relevant bodies. So it's about sending someone this year, next year, and creating personal and business relationships for the future of the city. It might not happen overnight. Relationships and transactions don't necessarily happen overnight, but what we are doing is building a relationship. You do business, you do good things with people you know, and you build a relationship with. And that's what these delegations are about. Not to mention the fact there's lots of South Australian businesses attending these delegations where local relationships and connections are formed, and that's equally important on a delegation than it is, you know, doing business with the host country. So this is a bit of a long-term plan where, as a city, we are building a relationship with. We work in a global environment now, and there's learnings to be shared bilaterally. There's business to be done bilaterally, and I think we need to be strategic and clever and long-term thinking about how we look at these international relationships, and sending people over is a critical way to do that. It doesn't happen on paper, it happens through conversations. So I encourage members to vote for this, and I look forward to hearing the outcomes that come from it.
Thanks, Councillor Maloney. So can I put the substantive motion? All those in favour? All those against? That's carried. Now, the substantive motion, members, calls for an additional elected member to participate. So I now call for nominees for that position. Councillor Martin, Councillor Caldwell was ahead of you.
Oh, okay. No, I didn't wish to nominate. I wanted to ask a question of the administration.
Can I just take the nomination first and then please go ahead? But
it's about the nomination.
Yep. Councillor Caldwell was ahead of you, so can I just deal with that matter first? Councillor Caldwell?
I would like to nominate Councillor Slama to be the elected member that supports the Lord Mayor's activities.
Okay. Are there any further nominees? Do you accept the nomination, Councillor Slama?
Yes, I do.
Thank you, Councillor Slama. Now, I think you can hold your seat while the question's asked. Just let me check that with...
Oh, look, it's somewhat redundant acting Lord Mayor, but I was simply going to ask the administration whether any conversations had been held with any elected member about this possible trip.
Yeah, well, I don't know the answer to that.
Matt Grant, thanks. Through Deputy Lord Mayor, there has been a meeting planning what the itinerary might look like, and there was a councillors were involved in that.
As in who?
Lord Mayor, Councillor Slammer, Councillor Caldwell.
Thank you.
You might recall, Councillor Martin, that quite early in this term, the Lord Mayor asked people to identify which of the sister city relationships they might want to build relationships with, and Councillor Caldwell and Councillor Slammer both indicated an interest in the China things. I imagine that's why they're included in those conversations.
Oh, look, I understand that. My point was that this is procedurally flawed. If the decision has already been taken, then there's no necessity for us to be going through this charade.
There's no decision being taken. We're about to take that decision. So, Councillor Sparman, we now need to vote, I think, which means you're going to have to declare an interest. Simply leave the room.
Excuse me, Acting Lord Mayor, and with great respect to Councillor Slama, if those discussions had occurred before we met about the possibility of the Councillor going to China, then isn't there a conflict of interest if you rise to speak in favour of the trip?
No.
Okay.
So can I have a motion to appoint Councillor Slama as the additional elected member? Moved by Councillor Corbell, and seconded by Councillor Milani. Is there any discussion on that issue?
Can I just say, Deputy Lord Mayor, what would be a learning from this is we do know when these missions are. We could bring them earlier to the chamber, and that would be a, because you do need to plan for these things. So I have no issue with the fact that, given that Councillor Slammer was there, there's follow-up from last year and there's some continuity. But I do think we could bring these things to the chamber earlier so we could openly, you know, that might satisfy the needs of other elected members. I have no issue with the current process, but it's a learning here that we could do.
Councillor Moran.
I have a problem with the current process. Clearly, these things should, while some councillors have shown interest, there's no point in any other councillor putting their hand up for this job, unless it's Councillor Corbell. That has been made very clear to us, and I think that this is a corrupted system, the way we're going through it, and I will be voting against Councillor Slam, not because I don't think he's able, because I think that to be tapped on the head, to be involved in pre-discussions, if not an actual conflict of interest, does not pass the pub test.
Councillor Moran, our CEO, I'd like to make a point of clarification.
Ian McGrath, thanks.
Through Deputy Lord Mayor, I just wanted to clarify the purpose of the meeting was to plan a schedule based on learning from the previous visits. And the councillors involved have been to China before.
So members, is there any further discussion on the appointment motion, or can I put it? So I put that. All those in favour? All those against? That's carried. Could we get Councillor Slama back into the chamber, please? Members, that brings us to item 6.4, close and transfer the public road west off Register Street. Have I got a mover? Have I got a mover for this item? Even just to get out of it going, Councillor Clarahan? And is there a seconder? Councillor Slama. Councillor Clarahan.
I recall this has been before us once before, and I expressed some concern about the consultation process. Could we just have an update, please, on the consultation process that occurred and whether there was any contact with the Thomas family and the feedback, which is not included in this, I don't believe, in this report.
Michael, thanks.
Through the Chair, this report has already been to Council in 2015, so this process of the road process order is an administrative process. The consultation, I'm not sure whether it's occurred with the Thomas family, but I'll need to follow that up for you.
Councillor Cohen.
I think on that basis, I'd like to remove my support for this motion because that I assumed that had occurred, given that I distinctly recall a requesting that that occur.
So, Councillor Clarion, I'm advised you just need to withdraw your moving of the matter.
I'll withdraw it, thank
okay,
you.
Okay, so now we've got Councillor Samuel as a seconder, but I need someone to move. Move by Councillor Moran. And Councillor Sammy, happy still to be the seconder. So, Councillor Moran. Councillor Slammer, do you have anything? Does anyone else wish to speak to this matter?
Did I read in here that there was only one response to the consultation from SA Water? I can't find it right now, but that's what I recall reading. So it has been to consultation.
Yes, but some people
Philip, would you like to expand?
Through the chair, that is accurate. The process that has occurred is that under the Local Government Act, it had to go through a process of deeming the road public, and then the process of closing the road and selling it to the uni for part of a DAC application. Subsequently, the uni withdrew their DAC application, so the consultation for making the road public became the basis under which the responses came in. It was only SA Water that that did respond to establish an easement along that road. The reason for my uncertainty, Councillor Clareham, was I wanted to check the report that's linked to from the 2015 reference, which is paragraphs 4 and 5, but I can't find reference in there quickly to the particular matter that you had described.
Any other members wish to speak to this? If not, I'll return to the mover, Councillor Moran. Can I put that? All those in favour? All those against? That's carried. Thank you, members. That brings us to item 6.5, compostable and reusable coffee cup pilot. Moved by Councillor Vershaw, seconded by Councillor Wilkinson. Councillor Vershaw. Will your voice hold out for this, do you think?
Here we go. I'm really pleased that this has come to council and scheduled to start next month. I had a couple of questions. One was how many cafes are in the area? Sorry.
She could do it by semaphore. So we'll answer that first question, perhaps give you an opportunity to get your throat working.
Michelle English, thanks.
Through the chair, there's 24 cafes or restaurants that use compostable or other types of disposable cups at the moment.
Thank you. Now, Councillor Vershaw's only asked a question at this stage, so we might come back to her if she returns to the chamber in one piece. Councillor Wilkinson, a second. Did you wish to speak to this or have any questions?
Yes, just in seconding this, I was very pleased to see this initiative, and it's something that I've always felt strongly that we shouldn't be putting all of this coffee cups into the waste stream when people could either be reusing reusable cups, and part of the report talks about suggesting that the cafes offer some discount to people who actually bring their own cup to refill, and there's nothing like letting economics work for itself, and if people get a 20-cent discount or something to reuse a thing, you'd be amazed how many people start reusing cups if that sort of behaviour is instilled. I'm not sure what discount. Perhaps the question would be, do we have an idea of what sort of discount would be offered for people reusing cups? But also, I'm just very pleased to see that they're looking here towards incentivising cups that can be composted in the green market waste. And hopefully the trend would get on to all cafe owners that people prefer to use coffee cups that they can put in the green waste rather than ones that go into landfill, and then there might be a market trend towards that. But I have a question on the amount of discount that might be offered.
So we don't have a figure at the moment. Obviously, this is a pilot that would involve us working with those businesses in the area. So there are a couple of businesses already that do provide a discount, so it's, but they don't have the signage in place, so it would really depend on a business by business case, and then obviously the rebate that they would receive would be on the basis of them providing that discount. And one of the other things would be providing signage to customers so that they're aware of that possibility.
Councillor Vishal. No, Councillor Carahan, beg your pardon.
Look, I just wanted to ask a question about the marketing, the extent of the marketing, and whether there was any consideration of actually messaging the compostable cups to reinforce the positive behaviour and the Adelaide City Council's endeavour to reduce landfill and therefore our emissions.
Through the chair. So one of the things that we have been looking at is the fact that many businesses actually use their cups as marketing for their own business as well, and including businesses that are within this area. So we'll be looking at how we can use marketing of those cups that is consistent with their existing branding but is also compostable. One of the other key things is the fact that we don't have standardised labelling for compostable materials as well, so we'd be looking at how we can incorporate those. We hadn't considered actually marketing this initiative ourselves on the cups, but perhaps using other forms of marketing materials and communication materials, but that's something we could investigate.
I think that's important. And one more question. Lord Mayor, I just wanted to ask a question about the events that was part of, I think, the initial motion in terms of encouraging people running events to use compostable cups. Now, is that being picked up by another section of council, waste area? Thank you.
Yes, through the chair. So we have through our strategic plan action in relation to having the waste streams looked at our events, so that is something that we're dealing as a separate matter. However, the learnings that we obviously get from this project, particularly in relation to the supply chain, feed into that issue as well.
Councillor Martin.
Yes, thank you, Acting Lord Mayor. Look, I will support this, and I think it's a good endeavour. And having spoken to Councillor Vishal, I know that she's pleased that we have launched this. I had some reservations, and I do want to ask a question. The reservations are that, having spoken to some cafe owners, their concern is that the cumulative payments are probably not enough when one considers that the minimum order for cups is around $25,000. That is $4,500, $5,000. So it's not huge. But my question goes to the majority of the way in which the majority of cafes operate. And that is, as I understand it, their coffee supplier, as part of their coffee purchase, provides the cups to them, and the cups are branded. Is there any potential for talking to suppliers at the start of the supply chain, rather than down the bottom of the chain as we are? And I don't mean that in any derogatory sense, but at the bottom of the chain where the consumer is.
Through the chair, absolutely, that's part of the research that we've done today in developing this pilot. We have been talking to those cafes in that precinct about their interest, but also to the suppliers as well.
Thank you.
Members, unless there's any further debate, I'll hand back to Councillor Vershaw to sum up. can I put that, all those in favour? All those against? That's carried. That brings us to item 6.6, members, proposal to declare Tavistock Lane a public road. Moved by Councillor Moran, seconded by Councillor Malani. Any debate? Do you wish to speak to Councillor Moran? Councillor Malani?
Thank you. Look, I think one thing I'm excited about this proposal is that we've been talking about these private laneways that we have struggled to do any maintenance or upgrade or uplift of because they're not ours. And I think this is an exciting step forward in how we can actually do that. Or I know this is a trigger for an opportunity for two developments to occur in that space, which I think is great. But I guess it also puts a question on the table about how we can look at the laneways off Gawler Place that are in the same similar situation as this and what precedent this sets. The other thing I'd like to say on Tavistock, we've been working with council administration on Tavistock lane for some time because there are adjoining businesses that want to activate it. Will they still have the opportunity? They wanted to have parklets, like Amalfi sits on that corner, for example. Is that going to open up this opportunity to do so? Or is the development going to prohibit that? Or
Justin Collins, thanks.
Through the chair, the conversion of the road to public provides the opportunity for the property owners adjacent to Tavistock to look at how they may activate onto Tavistock. How they do that will be subject to consideration down the track, whether it's parklets or otherwise, but certainly there, it opens up a lot of retail opportunity for those existing businesses.
And while I've got you, Justin, can I ask one more question? Because the process is complex. But I remember bringing a motion to council a little while ago about what other lanes are in this same scenario. Could you just give me an update where that's at? And because there are other lanes that we might want to learn about this process for.
Yeah, Michael Lupu, thanks.
Through the chair, council will receive a report on, I guess, a scoping document to help understand what is necessary. It doesn't necessarily set precedence because each one has to be considered on merit, and that'll be the basis of a report that will come back to council for further consideration.
So that's work in progress, you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks, Councillor Maloney. Does anyone else wish to speak to this? Councillor Wilkinson.
When this matter first came to council, we had discussion about our desire to see the historic Gerard and Goodman building actually retained. And the discussion went on the long lines of we'd be open to doing what was being sought of us, which was basically to avail this laneway to the developer of Chiron Group of this site, if they retained the historic Gerard and Goodman building. It's actually been featured in postcards of Adelaide. And I was advised by the Lord Mayor that they've since changed the design so that there was no reliance on this right of way whatsoever, and therefore the council effectively had no leverage to seek the retention of these buildings. But now, and in reading the report, the scheme was changed to not rely on this roadway, and then an application was obviously lodged to demolish the historic Tavistock Lane, the Gerard and Goodman building, which was on access. You look down the lane, think about great lanes in Adelaide, it's a beautiful terminal vista. They could have created an opening, a driveway opening, driven underneath it like you do with the central markets, but instead that's just been demolished today. And Synagogue Place, where this is a beautiful, has gone. And then the scheme's been amended to then once again and rely upon this laneway now that the building's been demolished. So I look upon this whole exercise rather cynically, that they changed the design so that they weren't reliant on this, demolished the building, now there's nothing to argue about, and now that the building's been demolished, Synagogue Place is poor for it. Now they're asking for permission I think it's a rather cynical exercise, and it's most unfortunate. The only positive thing I can see of this laneway, and I know we have received some correspondence from the developers in relation to the site, is in relation to how the Frome Road bike lane will affect the proposed hotel. So, you know, the only possible good that might come from this is that they might be able to get a hotel loading dock that uses this way, rather than them also seeking some special change of design to the Frome Road bikeway on Frome Street, which I could see happening. So, you know, I mean, I'm going to be voting against this for the reasons why I've just said, that I think we've been done over, personally. We've lost a beautiful building and talking about great laneways, well, we won't have it because we've lost all the nice buildings on the laneway now, except for Amalfi's, which isn't heritage listed either. Luckily, it's still there by luck. But at least we might be able to see a hotel vehicle loading thing that is done off this load, off Tavistock Lane rather than off Frome Road. So I hope that in the discussions that I had with our administration and the Chiron group, that if this comes to pass, that it's done in the expectation that that's where their loading is going to be, and not on Frome Road, where it will create more conflicts. We've already got conflicts with another hotel on Frome Road, which was pre-existing. It was built long before the Frome Road bikeway was ever envisaged. We've got an opportunity to get it right this time.
Thank you, Councillor Wilkinson. Anyone else wish to speak to this?
Just for clarification, for the benefit of councillors, the demolition of the building, which is on private land, was always going to occur through the Development Application that Chiron put to the Development Assessment Commission. Whether Tavistock Lane was converted to public or not, that was not going to change the fate for that particular building, which was on private land. So the changes to the approvals sought from DAC wasn't in the context of trying to get around whether to demolish or not. That building was always going to be demolished.
Members, anyone else wish to speak to this? Otherwise, back to you, Councillor Moran, as mover.
Yes. I think what Sandy was trying to say, and what did say admirably, is that we had leverage there.
Yes.
While we hadn't declared the lane public, that they may have always intended to pull the building down, which is a shame, but we kind of, it has a sad turn of events that we couldn't use our leverage. However, in moving this motion, we have to vote on what's here in front of us, and unfortunately the building's gone today, and to make the lane public is beneficial.
Thank you, members. Can I put 6.6 to you? All those in favour? All those against? That's carried. That brings us to 6.7, unique proposals. Do I have a mover? Moved by Councillor Malani. And a seconder? Members, can I have a seconder? Councillor Swama. Councillor Malani.
Thank you. I think this is a good piece of policy work where I guess for some time now we've been talking about some public-private partnerships and how we can put some policy around that. So I welcome this piece of work, and in fact we know that we don't have all the ideas within this organisation, and that we need to collaborate. That's an important part of our role. But what this does is put some parameters and a framework around that. So I urge members to support this proposal, this policy document, guidelines, and let's see what feedback we get from the market. Let's see what blue sky thinking we can encourage, and ideas that we can now encourage to come into this organisation in a professional and a formal process, so that we can then use our own intelligence in this organisation to then see what is worth pursuing with private sector. Thank you.
Thanks, Councillor Malani. Councillor Slama, a seconder, do you wish to speak?
I reserve my right.
Councillor Moran and then Councillor Martin.
Look, I really don't understand this motion. A unique proposal, it's rather sort of oxymoron to say that then you have a procedure to deal with a unique proposal. A unique proposal is something that comes up once in a lifetime, is outside all the boundaries, has no policy. I'm very nervous when I read this, that before that we've dealt with it a case by case. Well, surely that would be obvious, that if it's a unique proposal, it would be case by case. I'm not sure how many unique proposals we have. Blue sky thinking makes me feel very nervous. I think for a council, we should be doing very little blue sky thinking and doing a hell of a lot of practical, sensible thinking. So I'll vote against this. I have never heard of a unique proposal. I don't know what a unique proposal is. I certainly don't want to have waste our time working out parameters for blue sky thinking. I think this is a load of rubbish, and I think that it could easily lead to some very dodgy behaviour by this council.
CEO, before I come to you, Councillor Martin, just the CEO wants to make a comment.
Through you, Deputy Lord Mayor. Just to clarify, the unique proposal term has been used elsewhere as unsolicited bids, and they're two and the same thing. So perhaps we've not been quite as clear as we should be in using the term unique proposal, but that's the intention. It is unsolicited bids that we receive on a relatively frequent basis from a variety of agents, and at this stage we're unable to deal with them. So this really provides an opportunity.
Excuse me, can I just ask a question then? When this report says that the unsolicited bids have been dealt with in a case by case, it doesn't say that we have never dealt with them. We can deal with unsolicited bids, and we do deal with them. This is putting a whole sort of framework of legitimacy around something that should be dealt in a case by case, and we have dealt with them.
Councillor Martin, sorry, now to you.
Yes, a question to the administration. Does this apply to the parklands?
Yeah.
It does. Okay. Has it been before APLA? Why are the members of APLA still in council? I would have understood under the conflict of interest provisions that if the matter hasn't been before APLA, they should not be in the room.
So can we get some governance advice on that?
This is policy, not dealing with it. Sorry.
This isn't good policy. You've got us stumped, Councillor Martin. Can you just give us a moment, Councillor?
Sure.
A response from our administration on that?
Through you, Deputy Lord Mayor. At this stage, on the limited information we have, or the time we've had to deal with it, we believe that dealing with this matter in the way we are is appropriate. It's not a decision for a project, it's a policy position of council that we're dealing with at the moment. So any particular proposal would go through the normal course of being referred to at the time.
Well, then the conflict of interest provisions are clear. The members of APLA are not entitled to be in the room.
Yeah, the advice I've been given is because it's
well, no, if policy. Well, no, if it's not been before APLA, just the same as if anything were to come up in regard to any other matter on which a member of this council sits on a board or an authority, then my understanding of the conflict of interest provisions is that they would absent themselves from the room.
So my understanding of the answer is that if and when a proposal comes, that is the case, but in the setting of a policy as to how a proposal will be dealt with, that's not the case, but I'll see if I can get some further clarity on that.
Well, through you, Lord Mayor, I think what the response and the position of administration is quite clear. However, I'm happy, if council is not confident with that advice, I'm happy to take it on notice, and we can refer this report back to council next month.
Well, look, I think, Acting Lord Mayor, that's an appropriate course. I was going to propose that the matter be deferred. And I would like to make the point also that this is the glaring fault in the abolition of the committee system. This would have previously come before a committee, there would have been a full and open account of what it was intended to do, an opportunity for Councillor Moran to ask her questions about what's different between this and what's happened before. There would have been an opportunity for us all to contribute in some way and to seek definitions. For example, there's none that I can see about actually what the criteria is for a unique proposal. I can't find it anywhere. And additionally, I'm not certain about the definition of exclusivity periods, how they operate, what the criteria is for council pulling the plug. And then there's that secrecy provision, which seems to run counter to everything this council has promised in terms of this being an open council. So had this come to committee, it would have been dealt with, and then something that was presentable could have been debated and probably approved by council. So,
Councillor, you've indicated that you want to defer it.
That would be my motion.
So, you're seeking to amend the motion in order to.
Yes, I would ask.
So, just one moment. The question is: are you asking that it be deferred to committee?
Yes.
The committee.
Yes. What I propose is that council defers the assessment of unique proposals guidelines to a committee at a date to be determined by the administration.
And that's seconded by Councillor Clarahan. Sorry, you've spoken to that really to some extent, Councillor Marsden. Anything else you wish to say?
In proposing that, Acting Lord Mayor, I would just ask the administration to seek clarity and advice in regard to the positions of those members of APLA in discussing this before it goes to APLA. That's a really important precedent that needs to be sorted out.
The CEO is asked to make a comment, Councillor Martin, and then Councillor Clarendon will come to you as the seconder of the amendment. One moment.
Through you, Deputy Lord Mayor, just to be really clear, the system is as we are dealing with it currently at the moment, that council administration is available to respond to council member questions throughout the period in between council meetings. Any council member that comes to a council meeting with an item that they're not happy with can easily move to defer to a committee or to a subsequent council meeting where further information will be provided. So in my view, this is how the system is operating correctly.
Can I respond to that, Acting Lord Mayor?
Actually, I prefer you didn't, because Councillor Clarahan's the next speaker.
No, I understand, but the CEO was raising with me a matter of
But we're not going to enter into debate about that, Councillor Martin.
No debate.
Councillor Martin, I'm the chair, and I'd like Councillor Clarahan to speak. I'm happy for you to take that up with the CEO outside of the meeting, but he's made it clear. Councillor Clarahan.
Thank you. Look, I've got a lot of questions, and lots of alarm bells went off when I was reading this report, and I thought, really, this has come too far before we have had an opportunity as a collective group to actually ask questions and to be able to discuss some of our concerns. So I support the deferral of this. As Councillor Martin has already identified, there are a considerable number of matters for concern. One of them, for example, is does this mean that it'll be open slather for cashed up proponents? Does it mean first in best dress because of an exclusivity principle period that's been included? And also, will it take 90 days before council even gets to hear about any unique proposal? So I think there are lots of questions that we need to ask and to be happy and confident that this attempt at openness and transparency, and I do acknowledge this is an attempt at a good model to improve transparency and openness, but I just think that it's too early for us to be signing off on this without the opportunity to ask questions and seek clarification.
Thanks, Councillor Crohan. Councillor Corbell, on the amendment.
Just a question, with this new guidelines that we're looking at introducing, at what point would it be renewed or revisited or reviewed? Has it got that written in there anywhere? At what point it would be reviewed?
Colleen Bennett, thanks.
Through the presiding member, no, it doesn't, but that's a good piece of feedback that we should be taking on board.
Okay, look, I'm going to support the deferral. I just think it's going to alleviate a lot of the concerns that have been raised already. And it is an important document, which we really should have, and we probably should have had it a long time ago, just to give clarity around how unsolicited proposals put forward before council and the administration might be handled, and it gives some guidance. So it is an important piece of work, but it would be better for us to have an opportunity to provide input into it rather than have it brought to us in this manner. So I'm supporting the deferral so we can have a bit more of a discussion around it and maybe revisit when this document might be reviewed as an example.
And Councillor Malani on the amendment.
Thank you, Deputy Lord Mayor. Look, I'll never say that a deferral to get more information isn't a bad thing if elected members choose that. We've had a number of workshops on this. We've talked about private public partnerships. We've done a lot of work on the benefits and the framework in which we've given feedback in which they should operate. So I just urge members to maybe go back to some of those conversations we've had. And maybe the language is confusing. That's only feedback I'll give now. Maybe we're trying to be too cool about what is an unsolicited bid or what is a public-private partnership or maybe unique proposal is a bit confusing. But I actually think this is a very good piece of work. It's encouraging the private sector and individuals and organisations to think about what they can contribute to the city. It's a professional way in which, you know, we've had circumstances before where it's kind of been, well, the CEO's had a meeting with someone and, oh my God, what's going on? This clears that up. This eliminates that. So this is a good piece of policy, and I hope in the workshop we have a good discussion about the benefits of it, and then we get on with encouraging those conversations.
Councillor Slama.
Thank you, Deputy Lord Mayor. I supported this as it was, but I'd be happy to take it, to defer it, although I don't personally see the need. I think this is an awesome bit of work, and, you know, for a private operator, it's very simple to follow what goes on here. There's three stages: initial proposal, detailed proposal, and contract negotiation. Everything comes to an elected member after and only when the initial proposal is put up. It's got to be on page 47, and the elected members get to vote on bits and pieces. So I don't see what the big deal is. This shows progressive thinking on our administration behalf to eliminate bureaucracy and unnecessary delays. Like, it takes a long time to get stuff done. I think this is a great bit of work, administration, and I certainly welcome.
Anyone else wish to speak on the deferral, or can I go back to Councillor Wilkinson?
I'm heartened by Councillor Slama's words, but I would take some comfort in having it workshop. I was a bit nervous when I was reading the report about what was intended, so take some comfort from just what Councillor Slama is saying, that I think will be helpful just to go through the process.
Thank you. Councillor Martin, back to you as the mover of the amendment.
Summed up, thank you, Lord Mayor.
Thanks, Councillor Martin. So can I put the amendment, all those in favour? That's carried. So that becomes a substantive motion. Do we need any further debate? Can I put that? All those in favour? That's carried. Brings us to item 6.8, Quarterly Forward Procurement Report. Can I have a mover, please? Moved by Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor Moran. Councillor Martin.
Reserve my right.
Councillor Moran. Back to you, Councillor Martin.
Thank you so much.
Can I put that? All those in favour? That's carried. Thank you, members. Item 6.9, Rundlemore Management Authority Operational Charter Update. Now, before you stand, Councillor Malani, I've taken some advice about this, but I need to draw your attention to a typographical error before we do anything. So on page 64, if I can just point out to you that where it says in items 1.1 and in items 1.,  in items 1 and 2, it refers to section 6.1.1. That should read 6.1. So please delete that second point one.
Section
16.1, beg your pardon. Now,
it's 6.1.1, is that
one? No, it should read 16.1. I beg your pardon.
Oh, it's 16.1
rather than 16.1.1. So it's just a matter of deleting that last point one.
Got it.
Okay, so that we now have the recommended motion in front of us. And Councillor Mulani, you're on your feet.
I'd like to declare conflict of interest given I'm on the Rundle Law Management Authority.
Now, I am advised, Councillor Mulani, that members of the Runnymede Management Authority are entitled to stay for some of the debate if they want to. It's only when we start to talk about the composition of the the board that you need to remove yourself. But if you still want to remove yourself now, that's a matter for you.
Look, I think it's easier just, I mean, the authority has dealt with this charter and reviewed it. I'm comfortable that I can leave it in the hands of the elected members in the room.
Thank you, Councillor Mulani.
That's okay, so exactly the same for me.
Thank you, Councillor Slama. Have we still got a quorum? Yes, we do.
Yeah, that's the question. Yeah, you're
So, a mover, Councillor Moran, and a seconder. Members, I have a seconder, at least for the purposes of the debate. Councillor Antic. Councillor Moran.
No, I don't, Mr. Bader. Same sense.
Councillor Antic.
No, thanks.
Now, members, can I just draw your attention to something, and I'll ask Judy to interrupt me if I've got something wrong here. As it currently stands, you are adopting the Charter of Rundlemore Management Authority with the exception of section 16.1. And then that's what you're doing in part one of this recommendation. In part two, you are noting that the consultant has made a recommendation in relation to section 16.1 that we either have two council members or one council member represented on the Rundlemore Management Authority. We are going to need to sort that out tonight. So we really will need someone to move a paragraph three, indicating either that we accept the charter as it is, which is one member only, or we revise the charter, or 16.1 of the charter, to make it two members. So to sit on the Rundlemore Management Authority, bearing in mind that this doesn't come into being until the next term of our council. Councillor Martin, can you help me here?
Yes, look, I can, Acting Lord Mayor. I will be moving a variation to the substantive, but I do have some questions that may influence that.
Okay, so just let's ask you questions first, and then the variation, you mean an amendment,
unless
somebody's willing to adopt it as a variation. So
yep.
Please go ahead and ask some questions, and then we'll see if that takes us a bit further down the track.
Sure. I wanted to ask the consultant's not here?
Three different women. No, he's not tonight.
Okay. What are the significant differences between this charter and the previous one, especially in respect to 8 at page 73 and 11 on page 74.
Can I get an answer to that, please?
There's a summary of the change of camera, aren't
thanks. Through the presiding member, the majority of the changes are just reflecting contemporary governance. It's a clean up, a tidy up of the language and terminology in general. In relation to the powers and functions, they in the previous charter version were a bit all over the place. They were not quite listed in the same heading, so they've been now condensed into one concise heading.
Okay, well look, I'll be specific, because I remember under the old committee system, how I missed that committee system. I remember under the old committee system, there was a discussion about this charter, and a proposal that I see is incorporated in here that allows the Rundle Mall Management Authority to get grants and subsidies without reference to this council. So the Rundle Mall Management Authority, if I'm reading it correctly, and I would like an answer, can go to the federal government and say, give us $10 million under safer streets, you know, better bollards, whatever, we'd like that money tomorrow. Is that right?
And an addendum question, if I may, is that a variation?
In the new charter numbering, section 8.7 provides that the authority has the power to make submissions for and accept grants, subsidies and contributions to further the authority's objects and purposes. And as far as I understand, that was equally the case in the previous, or in the current charter, I should say.
I thought it was proposed. I apologise that. Was it also the case that the authority can raise funds outside of the levy on Rundle Mall traders for, and I note at 11, emergency or hardship reasons? Is that one new?
I need to take that on notice and check that, actually.
Okay, and can institute legal proceedings, I note, against council as well? It doesn't seem to discern there.
Technically, that would be impossible because the council can at any one time override the subsidiary. So section 10 of Schedule 2 of the Local Government Act provides for council to at any one time be able to override the board's decisions. At the end of the day, the authority is a subsidiary of the council.
So that would require the approval of council?
The authority has the power to initiate legal actions. However, if the council will decide that these actions are inappropriate, the council can then, applying section 10, Schedule 2 of the Local Government Act, override that board decision.
And I note from the new charter that the authority can contest council prices and contracts. Is that correct?
Competitive neutrality is already included in the Local Government Act, regardless. Yes. So this is just making it clear
that's
the case in the charter. So it's just a matter of clarity.
And I'm confused. 8.12 at page 73 says the authority can sell or lease or whatever any property it likes, but at page 24 it says that all property held by the authority is owned by the council. Now, how does that work?
So in relation to leasing, again, it's clarifying that the authority has the ability to do that. If the authority were to purchase goods, then the authority can do so within the approved budget allocation approved by council, that is. So leasing versus ownership, is that what you're referring to, Councillor?
I guess what I'm asking is, at one part of the charter, it says that it can sell and do what it wants with property in the name of the authority, but the property actually resides in the council's ownership according to another section. That section is page 74.
Yeah, ultimately it is a council subsidiary, so all property will be held on behalf of the council.
Okay, all right, look, I thank you for that. I am a bit overwhelmed by all of this, not least because there isn't in the documentation anything that points out the differences between the old charter and the new charter. And certainly in the old days, with the committee system, the author of the report would have been in the room and we would have been able to ask questions.
Councillor Martin, there is a detailed overview of the suggested changes in the linking in paragraph 4, but of course I've only got a hard copy in front of me at the moment.
I did review that, yeah. Acting Lord
Mayor.
But
you're right, there's not a marked up copy, which does make it tricky.
No, it makes it very, very difficult to read. Look, I want to propose a variation in respect of another part, and it is that 16 of the charter be amended so that 16.1.1 is deleted And so 16.1.2 becomes 16.1.1, and parentheses B of the amended 16.1.1 becomes up to 6 board members with an appropriate range, blah, 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 blah.
And now, Councillor Martin.
I have already given the...
Okay. I'm just going to refer that request to Judy Speck, because she's got some comments on the practicalities of how we might best do it. But I'm not trying to interrupt you, I'm just trying to find out how we do it.
Members, if I can draw your attention to the motion that is before you at the moment. The motion at the moment indicates that you are adopting the Charter excluding 16.1. And part two is asking you to note a recommendation and then consider 16.1 separately. So therefore,
I do understand that, yes.
Parts one and two can be dealt with in their own right, and the matter that you're referencing, Councillor Martin, can be dealt with as a motion.
So, and look, I have to say I'm confused because of the numbering issue here. So what you're saying to me is, Councillor Moran's proposal to adopt as printed relates to one, and if I wish to amend two, that is a separate action to be put to the meeting.
No, Councillor Moran has moved one and two, and that's been seconded by someone whose name I can't find.
So I'm amending two, is that correct?
So I'm not 100%, I think if I... Perhaps you could just explain to us what you're seeking to do, what the outcome is.
What I'm proposing to do is to change that section 16, appointment of board members, which the consultant has proposed is no longer relevant, that we should reduce our representation on the Rundle Mall Authority from 2 to 1, and that amendment that I proposed reduces representation to 0.
Oh, I see.
And therefore adjust the number of board members.
So I'm going to suggest a way forward, and then I'll ask Judy Speck to comment on it. So I'm suggesting that we deal with paragraphs 1 and 2, we leave them as they are, and then we include a paragraph 3, which is at 16.1, read blah.
Well, that would be in direct contravention of 2.
No, because all we're doing in 2 is noting what the consultant's advice is. That's all we're doing. So, you know,
so what you're proposing is what I proposed.
As a paragraph 3, that's all.
As a paragraph 3.
As a paragraph 3.
As an amendment. No, it's pretty straightforward. It's just that the process is...
Okay, so the motion is actually, if we can adopt it as paragraph 3, which is up there on your, it's on the screen in front of you.
Yep.
And so what we're currently doing is we're adopting every part, if we go ahead with this, or the motion as amended, oh hang on, before I do that, I better get a seconder for your...
Councillor Wilkinson has indicated for the purposes of debate.
One moment. Over to Ms Speck again.
Members, I've managed to confuse you a little. The motion before you refers to part 16.1 of the Charter in its entirety. If Council can consider part 1 of the recommendation in your agenda along with part 2 of the recommendation in your agenda, which has now formed the motion moved by Councillor Moran, deliberate and vote upon those two parts. The next part of this process is for you, Councillor Martin, to then move a motion to put before the meeting that which you want 16.1 to be.
I'll accept your advice.
Thank you.
Okay, so members, in adopting 1 and 2, what we're doing is we're adopting every part of the Charter other than the bit as to membership, to board membership, and we're noting the consultant's advice as to board membership. Are we happy to go ahead with that without any further discussion, putting 1 and 2? Okay, so can I put that, paragraphs 1 and 2? All those in favour? Great. Now, Councillor Martin, you have foreshadowed a new motion in relation to membership.
Yes, as was previously printed on the screen. Thank you.
So I need a seconder for that, Councillor Wilkinson. Seconded. So go ahead, please, Councillor Martin.
Okay, look, it's a very brief argument. I have a view that the proposed reduction of elected members who are also members of the Rundle Mall Management Authority should be reduced to zero. The author of the report has already identified significant changes. That is that the Lord Mayor shouldn't be entitled automatically to a seat on the authority. That's a recommendation. Nor should the Lord Mayor have the right to nominate a member of council to the authority. But significantly, the author says the conflict of interest rules are a problem. Every time a matter about the authority is raised, which has not been before the authority, which the elected member could presumably brief us on, they have to leave the room. And recent advice from the administration separately sent to us all says the first duty of an elected member on a board such as the RMMA is to the board, not to the council. So they can't tell us a thing. I'm not sure why they're there or what the value is. Well, I know what the value is. It's about $10,000 in sitting fees every year. But the real cost, in my view, is that by having elected members on the board, silent in this room, unable to brief us, is that we are denying the board the opportunity of having a more experienced voice. That is someone who has expertise in the area that the authority needs and not the political numbers in the room to get on the board. And that's a really significant issue. We are, in my view, denying the board the opportunity of the skill sets that it really needs by insisting that there's a member of council there who can tell us nothing in this council. Well, very little anyway. And so that is why I've proposed the amendment. It is not for any other reason. And under this system, it would be my contention that the chair of the board and the CEO would then report to council in a way that was transparent and one would hope regular. But the way the system operates, I can't remember the last time I saw the Rundle Mall Management Authority chair at a council meeting or briefing. I honestly can't remember. And that's not a reflection on them. It is what I say is a fault in the system that burdens us with this situation in which the council is by and large unaware of what's happening on the Rundle Mall Authority. The elected member on the authority can't speak to us because of conflict of interest rules and because of directions that they have a primary responsibility to the board, and the second, that we just don't have any visibility of the chair of the board. And finally, and perhaps more importantly, we are denying the authority the expertise they could otherwise have on the board to enable them to function properly. That's the argument in a nutshell.
Councillor Wilkinson. Councillor Moran.
Yes, I will vote against this removal of an elected member, a council member from a very powerful subsidiary that can buy, sell, let. Okay, it has to come back to council, but these subsidiaries are very strong satellite groups from council. And while I'm happy to go to one, I'm not happy to go to none. I think it's a bit rude saying that the skill set out there. I think that a councillor, Central Ward Council particularly, would have the skill sets and the interface with the public that should be on the board. I'm disappointed that Councillor Sam and Councillor Malani left for my motion. They obviously would have had to leave for this motion, but they were clearly told that they did not have a conflict of interest. They erred on the side of caution because everybody's nervous about the severe penalties now for crossing into conflict of interest. But they do not have a conflict of interest. Not that I'm criticising them for leaving, but they did not have a conflict of interest. They could have stayed here and shared their experience with us. They chose not to because everything's in a state of flux. I'm quite sure that the conflict of interest laws now are unjust and do stifle involvement in things like in board membership, but I'm confident that these will be changed soon. But once you get rid of your representative on these boards, you lose control. If you don't see if you're not seeing the subsidiary chair often enough, ask to see him more often. But at least the saying that you answer to the board, not the council, well, that's really up to you, isn't it? I mean, I've been sat on boards and I always answer to the council, not the board. Nobody can make you take your council hat off. That is why you're sitting on the board. So it's a nonsense to say potentially you'll do something that will damage council because you've taken your council hat on. Every councillor on a board is a councillor on a board. So I urge you to vote against this. It undervalues the council's participation on these boards. We have little enough representation on anything now. Our roles are slowly being whittled away and marginalised. And this is just, while there are a sensible reason to the current situation won't last forever. With the change of the state government, these things will be reviewed again, or hopefully reviewed before that. But once you're gone, you never come back.
Councillor Moran, before you sit down, you mentioned that you'd be happy with one person on the board rather than two. And we are going to need, if this doesn't get up, an alternative. Are you willing to
foreshadow?
Thank you. Councillor, my glasses are broken. Anybody else wish to speak to this? No, then back to you, Councillor Martin, for your summary.
Yeah, look, just in response to Councillor Moran, look, respectfully, I said nothing about councillors, elected members sitting on boards doing damage to those boards. That was not the intention. What I did say was that by having an elected member there who doesn't have the skill set or choice of the authority, we are denying them that experience. That is all I am saying. And because of that, I'm saying that we are, to some extent, unnecessarily burdening the authority. Now, I acknowledge that it is possible for councillors to see the chair of the board, but in reality, that doesn't happen. It's not likely that the authority chair would, and quite reasonably, accept 12 appointments at any time in the year to review the activities of the authority. And furthermore, there's something to the formality of posing questions to the chair that would be, I think, in the better interests of council. However, I have that unmistakable feeling that this is going down, and I am prepared to accept that, but I am saying to the council, this is a serious issue. It is a reasonable point of view that I am putting, and it is something that will not go away in my view, that will come back and will need to be considered at some stage in the future.
Thanks, Councillor Martin. So can I put Councillor Martin's motion? All those in favour? All those against? So that fails, and back to you, Councillor Moran, to, I think, put in an alternative. Another, a new motion, which apparently is on the board. Is that is it coming up?
Okay, I move that council adopt the proposed. Oh man, it's moving around. Adopt 16.1 as including attachment A and under 6.9, blah, 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 that the board consists of a maximum of 7 board members as follows. 16.11, one board member must be a member of council, appointed by council, and then 16.12, up to 6 board members must be appointed by the council as follows. One with board leadership experience will be nominated by council's chief executive officer to be a board member, and the chairperson following the expression of interest process. B, up to 5 board members with appropriate range of skills and experience will be nominated by the council's CEO and the chairperson following an expression of interest.
Okay, I think we've got that. Have we got a seconder for Councillor Moran's motion? Seconded by Councillor Antic. Do you wish to speak to that, Councillor Moran?
No, I don't.
Councillor Antic? Anybody else wish to speak to it? Can I put it, all those in favour? That's carried. Thanks, members. So we can... We're just getting Councillor Milani and Sama back in. Now, you note in your agenda there's a key emerging, there's a note here about key emerging risks. So, and as soon as Councillor Milani and Slammer are back in, we're just going to pass to the CEO to make some comments on that issue.
Through you, Deputy Lord Mayor, there is one item in the confidential part of the agenda that's going to be raised relating to temporary infrastructure proposal. It's a commercial in confidence item, so that's why it's going to be considered as part of the confidential part of the agenda. So just putting that in front of council for knowledge.
Thanks very much, CEO. Questions on notice? Councillor Martin, you have a question in relation to the Local Government Act.
I have three.
Happy to take it as read?
Yes, I will take those as read. You're talking about the conflicts of interest?
I am.
Yes, I'll take those as read.
Okay, so do we need to do anything else there? No, okay, that move, we can move on then to questions without notice. Do we have any questions without notice? Councillor Martin.
Subsequent to the questions on notice with regard to conflict of interest, look, I have a question of the administration. In circumstances where a staff member, that is a member of the administration, feels that there is a conflict of interest, either perceived or material, is there an obligation on that staff member to report that conflict of interest, material or otherwise, which is held by the elected member?
Any response to that?
Rudy, thanks.
Through the chair, staff members are bound by the mandatory code of conduct, which is set for the whole sector. For local government in South Australia, it's the Minister's Code of Conduct that applies to all staff, and that talks to an obligation for all staff to declare conflicts when they arise. There is not such a level of categories like there is for matters under the Local Government Act and elected members, in that there's no material perceived or actual. The Mandatory Code of Conduct for staff actually talks about even a perception of a conflict of interest. So it's where there is a potential risk that the community may perceive that the right interests of the community are not followed through.
I just want to clarify.
Is that an answer to your question, or were you asking a slightly different question?
I was asking a slightly different question, Acting Lord Mayor. I was asking about the obligation of a staff member who becomes aware of a conflict, material or perceived, on the part of an elected member. What is their responsibility?
It's sort of a whistleblower responsibility
Through the presiding member, my understanding is that the obligations for staff members are different to those of council members from the training that we've received from Kennedy Jones, but we can take that on notice and get greater clarity.
So you're saying to me that there is not that obligation, so far as you understand, but you'll try and get clarity?
We'll get clarity for sure, but my understanding is that the obligations are different.
Thank you. Acting Lord Mayor, I have another question. Do you want to ask others, though? Thank you very much. I wondered if I could ask the administration, how many City of Adelaide staff will accompany the Lord Mayor, the Lady Mayoress and Councillor Salama to Qingdao in May?
Through you, Deputy Lord Mayor, that hasn't been resolved or determined at this stage.
Will there be a report at some stage to council before the trip, or it'll be a post-trip event?
Through you, Deputy Lord Mayor, the determination as to what staff are required to attend such issues is something I'll deal with as part of general business. So there will be no report to council seeking approval. It's just something that I'll determine when I've taken advice.
Thank you. And furthermore, during an interview on ABC Radio yesterday, during an interview on ABC Radio yesterday, reported in the media cuts that are circulated to councillors, Councillor Moran is reported to have said it would have been better for the Crows to take over the aquatic centre. Now, is the administration aware of any interest by the Adelaide Crows in moving to this community facility?
That's through you, Deputy Lord Mayor. I need to take that on notice. Thanks.
Can I explain that media grab thing?
I'd rather you didn't, Councillor Moran. It's
asking whether that would be a consideration, to which I said It could be.
Thank you, Councillor Moran. Questions on without notice? Any further questions without notice, Councillor Martin? Anyone else have questions without notice?
Yeah, I've got a question. As CEO, if we have a policy on unique proposals or unsolicited bids, would that be a good example of how we might actually have a process in place to manage those ideas?
I would suggest yes.
Thank you, Councillor Milani. Anyone else have a question without notice? Otherwise, we'll move to motions on notice. Okay, thank you. Councillor Moran, you've got a motion on notice at 9.1, parking fines.
Yes, I have. I move that Council review the current parking fine policy and set up a program to determine the number of fines people have so the policy can determine if a person is a first-time offender, first-time or one-time offender or a multiple offender. Part two, and if suits you, Madam, I'd like to take some parts. Council discuss the setting up of a subcommittee of interested councillors to consider contested parking fines.
So have we got a seconder for that, Councillor Wilkin?
Now, the first one, I would have thought that the administration report was what that we already did that, but I mean, I don't want to bang on about this too much. We've talked about this for years. None of us, and I think I could speak for most councillors, are happy with what is happening now. We've all had horror stories of, 94-year-olds with disability stickers that put the wrong one on, then she's come into town to show the right one and told, no, she can't have it waived. Now, because I have been, I was speaking to the Acting Lord Mayor today, because I have been banging out a lot, I noticed that that some that I wouldn't have waived are being waived. Out of a response, in my mind, to a keenness for the elected members to create a more welcoming feeling for their city, and our parking fines are rather, or how we deal with our parking fines. Clearly we have to have parking fines. But how we deal with them has been inappropriate in my mind, or not fulfilling the desire to have a fair, equitable and welcoming city. I think it's very important when you're looking at somebody who's got a parking fine, who's gone to all the bother of writing in, to know whether that's his 50th letter that year with the same problem, or he's never had a parking fine in his 75 years, and this is the first time he's got. I think that is just absolutely pivotal on whether you believe that person or not. I was surprised reading the report that I was expecting to say we already do that, but it's rather sort of wishy-washy. We could investigate it if we want to. If we get this motion, it won't be just if you want to, you'll be doing it. The second part is more contentious, obviously. Who wants to be the councillor on the subcommittee doing that? Could be very popular or very unpopular. That's why I put in the second part saying that we'd have to have that audited by an outside body. But I noticed in the report actually solves that. I'd suggest that 6.1 would be the way to go with that one, rather than setting up a subcommittee that, you say, yes, waive that one, no, don't waive that one. And I am only talking about the really contentious ones. So if I move this, I'd hope that it would just be taken as that would be what would happen. Understanding or the CEO can establish a working group of council, the CEO could seek the interest of two or three council members or however many, and a CEO working party could be established with a clear set of terms of reference to provide advice on matters. That I think I would be happy with having, I'd be really happy with the subcommittee of committee, and we could say yay or nay, because clearly, with all the pushing and criticism from the elected body, the council, this is not getting through in any satisfactory way after years and years and years of saying we must show more compassion. Number one, I think, is a no-brainer, but number two, I can understand if it's a bridge too far. So if you would take in parts, Acting Lord Mayor.
Councillor Moran, I'm just to get some clarity, are you actually proposing, Councillor, paragraph 2 as it stands, or are you proposing paragraph 2 varied to turn it into a working group? Because I think what's envisaged on page 89 as a working group is...
Well, it's this motion. It's
well, I can't really vary it, can I?
That's been seconded.
You can after it's been seconded, as I understand. So I'm just trying to get some clarity because it seems like you're asking.
If I'm allowed to vary it, I will add that it be on the model of 6.1. Is it 6.1?
6.1.
So that variation has been suggested by Councillor Moran. Do you second and happy with that variation?
Yes.
Does everyone understand the variation? Okay, can I put the variation to the chamber? Is everyone happy with that variation? Okay, thank you. Now, Councillor Moran, do you need to speak to it anymore? Councillor Wilkinson, a seconder.
I think the really important distinction of Councillor Moran's motion is the differentiating between multiple repeat offenders always coming up with different excuses and the ordinary person who once in a while occasionally has an oversight and a reasonable excuse, and that's what we're trying to make a differentiation between.
Thank you, Councillor Wilkinson. Councillor Malani, then Councillor Corbell.
Thank you, Deputy Lord Mayor. Look, I certainly understand the sentiment of where Councillor Moran is coming from. My question to first is, to me, this is an issue of culture, not necessarily policy. We specifically use the word policy in this motion. For me, for example, I would like to see us, and I've already had this discussion with some of the admin about the fact that we call up parking officers. I don't think officers is the right term. It's a cultural change, and I'd just like to acknowledge that there's some good work being done in this space and working towards this culture. So what we're trying to do is change a culture about how we make this more customer friendly, more welcoming. I don't think it's a policy. That's my question, because I'm a bit worried about the words we're using. We're using the wrong lever, maybe. So that I just want to ask that question. And if that is, I might get Councillor Moran to vary to make it fit better. But.
Okay, so administration, can we get a response to that?
I'll let me clarify. Do we have a parking fine policy? Is that the name of the policy we have?
Through the presiding member, we have a guideline which is called waiving of on-street parking and expiation waiving guidelines. So while the wording,
Councillor Moran's alluding to that piece of policy. My true feeling about this is it's not. I'm sure the guidelines are great, and set up a working group, we can change the guidelines. But I'm not sure it's going to solve the problem. I think we have to do, and I know we are working on this significantly. And we've even relocated that part of the organisation into customer service, which is a huge step for us to take in dealing with this issue. So I guess I'm trying to understand how we add to this, maybe, but it's not just about the guideline, it is about how we actually empower people to make decisions, how we create a more customer-friendly environment in which this sits. Is that a rhetorical question? I just don't know the wording is right, because just by coming up with the name, the number of first time versus, I don't think that's going to solve the problem. I think we've got, there's a bit more work to do here.
Is that part two?
Well, I'm certainly more happier with the 6.1 than the original. All right. Okay, I'll ask you, when the administration, if this passes, will the report review include what organisational elements and changes we are making currently to address the way in which we deal with this issue?
Through Deputy Lord Mayor, just to be clear, administration is doing a lot of work in, as has been stated, changing the way we approach our parking and our enforcement process. There is a lot of change happening at the moment, and we're starting to see some come to fruition, or some positive outcomes come to fruition. Perhaps I can hand over to Claire to explain maybe some more detail about what we're doing.
Through the presiding member, what I understand Councillor Malani is looking for is a bit more information on the cultural change that we're driving through the customer program. There's a large range of regulatory functions that were placed in that program last May, including environmental health, compliance, as well as on-street parking. The program has undergone a review, and the approach has been mapped out for the next few years in terms of what we hope to achieve. We have scheduled a workshop with council members, but not until June, to share with council the revised approach for that whole customer experience program. In terms of the specific aspects related to on-street parking, perhaps we can have that discussion with the CEO working group and test whether some of those cultural reforms are appropriate.
So I'll just take that as a yes, that will be included as part of it, because that gives me more sense of comfort. It's not just about the guidelines, it's a bigger conversation to have. And if there is a working group set up to look at those terms of reference, I think that's far more appropriate than a decision-making body on council.
Councillor Corbell.
Thank you, Mayor. I've got a couple of questions, and the first one is about the parking and expiation waiving guidelines. Our current on-street parking policy was approved by council in October 2001. Do our current parking and expiation waiving guidelines come from the same policy document?
Through the presiding member, they are informed by the principles contained within the policy document. The waiving guidelines were endorsed by the CEO back in 2013.
Okay, all right. Okay, thank you. That answers the first question. The second one was, do we already have a request by Councillor Moran as a motion about reviewing parking policy of this council on the books?
Through the presiding member, we have a request to review the residential parking permit aspect of the policy.
Later this evening, I'm moving a motion which is about reviewing council policy, and I expect that this on-street parking policy and its guidelines will come under part of that review, which I'm calling for, which is a large-scale review. And I won't speak to that motion now, but I do believe that this policy will come under that review process anyway, and it will include a series of workshops and so on. So I'm happy to support this, but I do expect that there'll be further work that needs to be done anyway, and it's not just this policy, it's a myriad of other council policies that need to be looked at.
Anyone else wish to speak to Councillor Moran's motion, or can I hand Councillor Perrihan?
Look, I applaud Councillor Moran for her concern around this whole matter. I mean, some of the cases that have been brought to us more recently does raise the question about whether we are sufficiently customer-focused or customer-centric. And one of the things that, and I do acknowledge also Councillor Mullany's comment about a culture, one of the things that concerns me is, do we really identify issues that arise and respond to them in a timely way to avoid multiple people getting tickets for unintentional breaking of the rules? And an example of that would be where we were shown an example recently where people were angle parking because they could see that most other cars were angle parking, and yet there were three or four car parks that had parallel parking, but were the lines painted on the road in a sufficiently clear way to show people that it was different to all the other parking? Some of our permit parking signs are really confusing, and I have to confess I'm forever in my own street running out to say to people, please don't park there, it'll spoil your night, you'll get a ticket. And they say, but oh look, and I'm saying no, it's only up until 6 o'clock you can park there, then it's a permit zone. So I think in those areas, we really do need to look for ways to actually prevent people from being, to receiving fines. And I think, whatever it takes for us to work at that level, we need to embark on it, because it really does ruin a person's experience of visiting a friend or visiting the city to shop or to do business or whatever. We can do better, I guess is what I'm saying, and whatever it takes, where if it's just a something that's done within administration or something that's also supported by some of the willing elected members to raise these issues with our administration, I think we can do well on that front.
Thank you, Councillor Corrihan. Anyone else wish, David, sorry, Councillor Simon.
Thank you. Just want to talk, I have no problem with the first part. I'll be voting against the second part. We're taking them in parts. I have little interest in getting together talking about parking, commenting on these issues as outlined in the second part. I must say, from experience, a couple of times when I've had issues with parking in general, I've addressed the CEO. The CEO has addressed his team and come back to me in quite a quick manner about what he thinks he could do and in what time frame they can do to address those. I've not had any response that, you know, I wasn't satisfactory with. Get to see some of those live out, and I think things take a little bit of time to change. So I've no interest in personally getting involved as an elected member reviewing who's in and who's out and why and why not. But the first part has some merit.
Thank you, Councillor Simon. Any other comments back to you, Councillor Moran, as mover?
Yes, just to respond to Councillor Slama, we have actually altered that, that the councillors will not be the decision makers in who's in and who's out, but form a CEO's committee of two or three. So Councillor Slama, even though you might not be interested, there are councillors that are interested, so I urge you to rethink your vote, as it wouldn't be what I would prefer, a yes or no, in or out, but I understand that's probably a world of pain for us anyway. But taking Priscilla's, Councillor Corbell, there are lots of policies that are a bit out of date and obviously need, but this policy is the one that is doing us the most damage, the most harm. If you took a vox pop down Rundle Mall and said, or to another shopping centre, why don't you go to Rundle, why don't you go to the city? Because of the parking fines. And the hard-nosed way that we're dealt with. If I had a dollar for every person that said, I got this parking fine, I had to da-da-da, you know, I was having my heart done at the Royal Adelaide Hospital, my doctor told me to stay a bit later. So I rang the council and they said, oh, well, we get stat decks from the ambulance person, this is that, oh, so they just don't believe me. So what you're setting out is a lot of people that, it only takes once not to be believed when you've written a long letter in to, for absolute outrage, I'll never come to the city again. You don't waive my fines. You're rude to me. And I think, Natasha, to answer yours too, I am putting in policy when I'm actually asking for a cultural change. But at 21 years, I have seen very little cultural change in this area. Last month, I've seen some movement towards that. But unless we embed something in it, the minute we're not looking at it, it has the potential to go back to the old culture. And this motion is the act of absolute despair at being able to change too much. But to credit the administrative staff that are making a good attempt, but they're, I don't know what's up in that office, but the horror stories that I get of people who have not believed. I've stood in our own customer centre and heard our staff berate people. And say, well, I don't think you're lying. I just couldn't believe it. So this might sound a bit hard and over, and we have to take it over, but we have to have more. We are the coalface. We live in this area, and these people come to us when they're not believed by the administration, and their feelings are hurt, and the fines are huge now. So it also has that sort of effect. It's not $30, and I wish I hadn't parked there. It's, oh, my God, you know, there goes Christmas. So I think we really have to step in. This hurts council, and it hurts us. And I think for over 20 years, until recently, the administration has not been listening.
Thanks, Councillor Moran. Just in the nick of time. And now, Councillor Moran has indicated that she's happy to take this in part, so I'm going to put part one. All those in favour of part one? That's carried. Can I put part two? All those in favour of part two? All those against? Part two is carried, I think. Can we take that again? All those in favour of part two? 1, 2, 3. All those against? Part two is carried. Thanks, members. Councillor Moran, you're also up again with major events.
Yes, now
9.2.
I understand, Acting Lord Mayor, there was a suggested addition to.
So, as I understand it, you need to put your motion, get a seconder, and then you can seek to vary. So, to add in a second paragraph. So, if you want, you put your motion as printed. Happy to do that?
Yes, I am.
And a seconder for that, Councillor Wilkinson. And then back to you, Councillor Moran, to seek to vary your motion by adding a second paragraph to.
I am afraid I haven't
up. Which is up on the screen.
Can I look at that? Can I ask a question? This is only talking about major events under the Act, right? I'm on a couple, I'm a board that is about an event in the parkland, but that's not under this category, am I correct? Just major, it just talks about anything under the Major Events Act.
So events just want to get declared major events under the Major
Events Act. Outside, but just checking, we're only talking about events under the Major Events Act. Am I clear on that?
Through the presiding member, that is part one. Part two refers to approval processes for council approved events in the parklands.
Okay. I'm going to remove myself then.
So, does that mean I also need to remove myself for the part two? Which means we've probably lost our quorum. Who else has to remove themselves for events in the past?
Sorry.
In those circumstances, I wonder if the simplest way forward would be to not make this variation and for that other issue to be addressed in a separate time.
Yep.
We're trying to knock off everything at one effort, but if that's going to be too awkward, let's just go back straight to the motion. So moved by Councillor Moran, seconded by Councillor Wilkinson. Okay. Councillor Moran.
So we're just talking about events under the Major Events Act.
Declared under the Act.
Well, this has obviously come up, this impost on our businesses in the park has come up recently with the Clipsal event and the for Arnie's kiosk. It was news to me that the businesses had to pay 28% of their profits during that period to the government, and also limited what they and purchased goods per the major sponsor for that event. That I imagine is something we can't get around, but I was going to move a stronger one that we put in our lease, that this the government couldn't do this, but apparently that can't be done. So I think we need to speak to the government about what happens to these businesses. They're our business, they're our lessees, and we need to look after them, and it does seem like they're being scalped. So I urge you to support this motion.
Do you have anything to add?
It's just interesting that where another entity has an opportunity to charge a food vendor in park lands, they charge in the order of 28%. And yet when we do events in the park lands, we provide a head lease for the entire thing for $28,000. It seems that the ratepayers are missing out badly. Whilst other people operating within the parklands are working on very much more commercial basis than we are, and as evidenced by the Arnie's kiosk having to fork out 28% of their takings.
Councillor Milani.
Thank you. I just want to ask the Clipsal scenario, which is the Rymal Park Cafe, and I'd just like to acknowledge, I thought that the Minister and the Tourism Commission handled that situation very well in working with the cafe owner. I just wanted to ask, though, that's under a different Act, that's not under the Major Events Act. Does the Major Events Act because that's a piece of legislation around a contractor under the whatever that Motorsport Act is. Under the Major Events Act, does it prohibit the traders from trading? I understand it's about sponsorship, it's about a whole lot of different areas. Does it specifically reference trading of businesses?
Through the presiding member, it, as you mentioned, it references sponsorship, and the intent of the Major Events Act is to protect events from ambush marketing. So for example, an event at the Adelaide Oval, there'll be an exclusion zone which picks up Elder Park. So if there is a sponsor in the Adelaide Oval for a car, Audi, then in Elder Park we wouldn't be able to put on a competing car show.
That's my understanding as well. But does it actually cover trading of like the lessees? My understanding is, yes, a lessee can't put an Audi if a Toyota is a sponsor. It doesn't actually cover, I just want to get clarity, does the Major Events Act include that kind of power? I don't know that it does. From a trade, like the cafe to open their doors and to take a commission, yes, that's in this Motorsport Act, that's a different, but under the Major Events Act, I don't think, is that provision there, am I right, wrong?
Through the presiding member, I will need to take it on notice. My understanding is it does give power to the state government to negotiate or at least have an outcome that protects the sponsorship of that major event. So my understanding that it does give power, but I will need to clarify the wording.
It does give power to take a percentage of sales.
That I don't know. I assume that is
a
negotiated outcome to...
That's what I'm talking about here. I'm trying to see where the problem is when the Act doesn't enable that.
Councillor Maloney, I'm just wondering whether reading the motion, which is quite wide and doesn't specifically deal with that particular question, but it just says that writes to the Minister, in order to minimise impact on businesses and facilitate mutually acceptable coexistence. I'm wondering whether that's helpful to you.
Yeah, look, okay, there's some generic wording there. Look, I just quickly summarise by saying, look, it's okay to have the conversation. The Minister's obviously open about it. He went down to Arnie himself and had a conversation. Kudos to him for doing that and resolving the issue. We want to get the balance right between, we have provisions in our leases to manage this, and we also want to enable events. So we're just trying to get the balance. I think that's what Councillor Moran is trying to achieve here, a bit of fairness. So if that's the intent, and then I'll vote for it in that context then.
Anyone else want to speak to this motion? Back to you to sum up, Councillor Moran.
I think kudos is too strong a word to give to the Minister. By the time the story had broken in the advertisement of Council, Council Laws had responded with outrage that our businesses were being gouged like this. I think any Minister would have had to go down and have a chat. We're not actually sure what the Minister did. So I think kudos really goes to us and the print media. I'm not sure how much kudos should go to the Minister, but however, I think this conversation has to happen. We were unaware of this sort of behaviour until businesses complained to us. So I assume that they haven't been gouged by as much as 28% in the past, as we would have heard of it. So I think we need to shine the light of public scrutiny on the government and these agreements with our businesses, and most of all, protect our lessees.
Thanks, Councillor Moran. So can I put item 9.2, all those in favour? That's carried, thank you. Brings us to item 9.3, which is a motion on notice from Councillor Antic. So moved as printed.
Moved as printed,
seconded, Councillor Moran.
So thank you, Acting Lord Mayor.
Just to paraphrase the motion, Acting Lord Mayor, what is being sought here is effectively a position from Council that Council indicate to the Minister for Tourism, who we just discussed, an indication that we will explore the viability of returning Formula One Grand Prix to the City of Adelaide. No more than that, no less, because of course members will be aware that we obviously don't have any say in that matter, but and that matter be put on the agenda for the Capital City Committee. So just to take members back, I think most of the people in this room are old enough to, remember the Formula One Grand Prix, except perhaps the acting lord, who looks too young, surely, to have been there in 1985. Be quiet, Philip. But, anyway, notwithstanding that matter. That's a fair point. Okay. Anyway, notwithstanding all of those very valid points, and my 3 minutes are elapsing, it was a terrific event. It did have a huge impact on the city, and it certainly put Adelaide on the map. And I think that much is very, very clear. It was a bit widely regarded as the finest street circuit of its era, and we are lacking that in South Australia at the moment, a truly world-class event. And it's sort of, in some way, kind of summarises the position we found ourselves in many respects in these times. We seem to have fallen behind the era where we would stand toe-to-toe with the eastern states and say, these events belong in Adelaide. So it dawned on me, I thought, well, this is a very valid consideration. We've got now, apparently, so rumour has it, some suggestion that there may be an opportunity for the race to be moved. And there is talk of Sydney jumping in and grabbing it, and it may well be that the answer is they can have it. Who knows? I mean, at the end of the day, we don't know the answer to that. There's a lot of conjecture, and particularly in the administrative comment about what it makes, what it loses, and all that. But I think what that fails to take into account is the truly world branding. I mean, the Clipsil race is fine on a national scale, but Formula One Grand Prix was a different year, and I really lament the fact that we've lost a lot of that blue sky thinking, Acting Lord Mayor, which is a buzzword which I certainly will endeavour to use as often as I can. But notwithstanding that matter, now interestingly, this matter did have comment through. I noticed the city ran a little piece on this, and the Tourism Minister, Leon Bignall, has slammed the Adelaide City Council's ambitious push to explore the viability of returning Formula One Grand Prix to South Australia. Mr. Bignall labelled the council clowns. Now that is, I mean, extraordinary flowery language, but not unsurprising. But he has, made the position loud and clear. But notwithstanding that matter, I think that's a matter for this to be played out in a formal term. And I say let's at least explore the opportunity. I'm quite happy to be told there is no chance, no desire, and no reason for us to even consider the matter, but let's do it. Let's ask the question. While strike while the iron's hot for some blue sky thinking.
Mix a few metaphors. Councillor Miranda, second.
I'll reserve my right.
Anyone else wish to speak to this item? Councillor Slammer.
Thank you. I do speak in favour. It's good to hear some blue sky thinking, and the first time I've ever heard Councillor Anty bringing out some marketing with his marketing hat on. He's out here looking at internationalising the city. Yep. He's concerned about the economic viability of the state, jobs, and all those good things that some of us councillors care about. So well done. 2021 is a critical year. I was thinking ahead, end of the V8 era. 2023, another critical year. So why not put our hat in the ring? No different to some of the other bigger projects, but if we don't put it out there, well, we just don't know. And we're sending the message to the government, we're sending the message to other stakeholders that, hey, we're in the run. The history of motorsport in this state is significant. We own it. We lost it. I think we should have a look at least getting it back. Bearing in mind that the significant investment going into Murray Bridge, Tail and Bend, I think it is, a sports park out there. So, you know, who knows how this will play out? It could be that the V8s go out there, we get the V8, the F1 back here. It could be numerous opportunities. I think we need to keep the opportunity open and send a message to through the Capital Committee to say, hey, we're open for business.
Councillor Malani.
Thank you. Yeah, we do have a good history of motorsport in this state. And I would love to see the Grand Prix here. I guess I've got the hindsight of being on the motorsport board for 5 years and probably have some some, you know, more insight into the industry. And I guess this is not the first time, and you're not the first person, Councillor Antic, to come up with this idea, but there's a practical reality to this. If you look at the admin comment, in actual fact, the cost of running the supercar race is significantly less than a Formula One, but the economic benefit is of equal or greater. So we've got to do some really simple maths on this. I think we need to be, you know, do our homework a little bit on it before we just say we want it to come here. I'm all for us throwing it out that we would support it. I just think that, you know, it's a different, it needs different infrastructure, it attracts a different audience. There's a lot of work that has gone on to assess this opportunity by state, by different people that have been engaged in the past. So I'm just a little bit confused about if we just write and say we want to have a Grand Prix here, we are going to sound a bit stupid. We just need to put some more thinking and substance to that. I would like us to take it in parts, if I may, because I'm happy for the Capital City Committee to workshop a process in which that can be done with state government, rather than just flying off and writing a letter saying this is what we want. Let's be a bit more smart about it, because and let's put a case forward, if that is the case. And obviously we have to look at what we would contribute. So that's a budget line that we'd obviously look at participating in some kind of sponsorship or whatever it might take. So there's a bit more thought that needs to be put into that. Don't get me wrong, I would love to see the Formula One back here, even though Formula One is sort of in a bit of a transitioning period. I just think we need to just not fly off and put a headline in the paper and say this is what we want. Let's, you know, put some robust thinking around it.
Councillor Antic, you've been asked whether you, I think, whether you're happy to take it in parts. Are you happy to take it in parts?
Yeah. Well, it's a yes or no.
Yes or no. Cheers, yep.
Yes, I think so.
Thank you.
Anyone else wish to speak to the... Yes, Councillor Clarahan, then Councillor Martin.
Look, I don't have any issue with writing to the Minister for Tourism and requesting that we explore the viability of the returning the Formula One to the City of Adelaide. There is no doubt about it. Adelaide, among the racing fraternity and the general public, has a reputation for having held the best ever Formula One event in Australia. And you will often hear people involved in that industry say, when Adelaide holds the event, it always feels like the whole city is behind it. Now, that may have something to do with the fact that it's located in the parklands, in such close proximity to the city, and there is, you know, people feel like the city is part of the actual event. However, what we do know is that the numbers were dropping, and many sort of, you know, felt that Adelaide had the race taken away from them by Bernie Eccleston just in time, because it looked like people were becoming a bit bored with it, and so we were quite relieved, or many were quite relieved when Melbourne took it on. I think one of the things that we'd love to see the return of, and that was the setup and takedown time that for all the infrastructure in the parklands that we experienced when Formula One was did happen here in Adelaide. It was remarkable how quickly they could set up the infrastructure for the race and get it down. Not unlike other European countries where the event occurs. The other point I wanted to make was about Formula E. There's been quite a bit of discussion around, especially given Adelaide Council and the state government's desire to have Adelaide become carbon neutral by 2025, that maybe Formula E is the way to go. But that can be all part of the discussion and all part of the of exploring the viability of putting our hand up for for the return of such a fantastic event.
Councillor Martin.
Yes, look, I echo that comment of Councillor Clearhands. We are supposedly a city striving to be carbon neutral, and there is something incongruous about hosting, you know, the biggest combustion fuel engine festival, you know, in the country. I also must say that I am reluctant to support this because we know so well what the Minister thinks of the proposal, having already said that he'll reject it and labelled Councillor Antic, I think, and Councillor Moran as clowns. And can I just say, can I just say, Acting Lord Mayor, there's not a hint of grease paint or false noses or big ears that I can see here tonight. There are no clowns in this council. There are, however, a lot of people who find that this is not a very funny issue. And I might draw attention to the angst that people are feeling about the current motor race that we have in the city, the Clipsal 500. It is it's astounding that the Melbourne Grand Prix has a setup and bump out time of about 10 weeks. And yet this Clipsal 500 that we host here in the city, and I'm grateful that this matter has been brought to our attention, the Clipsal 500 takes about 30 weeks, just under 30 weeks to bump in and bump out. Which means, of course, that Adelaide in motor racing terms is a bit like a tortoise compared to Melbourne's here. We are just so slow. Now, I want to say that, and I did read in the Advertiser a letter to the editor from a correspondent who said the disruption to our city by the motor race is simply no longer acceptable. And I endorse that entirely. It is not good enough for the people of this city to be denied access to their parklands for such a long period of time. And I think it is time that the minister, instead of calling this council clowns, put some clout behind trying to dismantle that infrastructure in better time. You know, maybe he could just hurry it along a week or two. Now, I understand the administration has worked successfully and persuaded the organisers to manage to slim down the dismantle this year by one day, and I'm very grateful for that. However, if the minister could really get behind it, we might be able to reduce it by a number of weeks, and that is the most satisfactory outcome that we could have for our ratepayers.
Councillor Corbell.
Thank you, Acting Lord Mayor. Sticking to the motion, I'm glad that Councillor Antic has accepted to take it in parts, because I'll support the second part about having this put on the agenda for the Capital City Committee. But I think it's just exasperating to write a letter to the Minister for Tourism after those sorts of comments that we've seen in the newspaper. And I'm interested to explore more the maths and the data behind it, in particular because we can see here that simple attendance figures over the last year, three years for the Grand Prix shows a decrease in the attendance. And I'm not exactly sure about how much it costs the City of Melbourne to put on that race, but we would then be taking on that burden. And then we would be saying farewell to the Clipsal, because we probably wouldn't have, it would be one or the other. And Clipsal has been quite popular and quite successfully supported by the state government and not so well supported by Adelaide City Council. Although we do put in $50,000 towards it, Minister Bignall's pointed out that it costs us costs them $100,000. From City Council's perspective, as per his remarks in that article pointed out by Councillor Antic. So despite Minister Bignall's remarks about us being some of the most infuriating people in South Australia, we are well-meaning. We do want the best for our city and we want the best for South Australia. So I'm happy for it to be put on the agenda at the Capital City Committee.
Councillor Moran.
Yes, look, I wasn't going to speak because I've already said a bit about this, but I think we do have to send the letter to the Minister now, because he's only heard of our request through the media, and as Alex Antic has written, we're not saying we want the Grand Prix, we're not saying we're setting up a case study to talk them into it, we're asking them to look at the viability of having it back. And that's a very measured thing to ask. I mean, obviously the time is coming where the Grand Prix is up for grabs,
And all this motion does is nudge the government to say, hey, look, let's have a look at whether it is viable for us to have it back. Now, the minister calling us clowns and telling us to get on and fix Frome Road and everything shows a level of ignorance and aggression towards us that I think, just to say, well, he's answered it, you know, he's called us clowns, he's called us idiots and everything, so he's answered it. Well, I don't think that's true. Obviously, it's not good enough. I think we have to write him now and explain what we were talking about, why we're not idiots and clowns, and that letter now has to be written to explain our position. Rather than just leave it being used through the press, I think it's necessary that we clarify what we're actually asking for. The capital city, in my opinion, is just some black hole that ideas go to and never come out again. I mean, that's lovely. Let's put it on there. Let it be something we put on. But I think the look, it's all a bit doomed, isn't it? It'd be great to have the Grand Prix back, but I don't think this government. I don't think this government has the blue sky thinking to do that. I also think that one thing that leads us to have to push them into asking the question about viability is clearly Clipsal reading the stats is possibly winding down. A big motorsport development's been building in Taylor Bend, but obviously people would be happy to go for it. Just to comment on what Councillor Martin said, the reason that Melbourne's so quick is it has a dedicated a park for it. It's not a street circuit. They don't have to build their buildings up. And I too was on the motorsport board for years, and while I think they could do it quicker if they had a bit more money, my impression was they were doing their best. It wasn't very good, but it was the best. So to compare Albert Park with Adelaide City is comparing oranges and apples. They just can't compare. We are not the slow coaches, and they're not the speedsters at all. But I think to encourage the government to look at an event that has an international reach rather than one that really doesn't and is winding down. We don't have the Ford Holden thing anymore. It also loses money, whereas it used to make quite a lot of money. So I think the signs are there that we need a replacement.
Councillor Antic, do you wish to sum up?
Yes, very quickly, Acting Lord Mayor, thank you. Look, a couple of things. First of all, that my reckoning of this is, my understanding is that on the last year of the Grand Prix in Adelaide, some almost 210,000 spectators attended the event, which has never been beaten by the Melbourne Grand Prix. In fact, our Clipsal numbers, as was reported in the media, apparently quite down as well. So in an ideal world, you might host both. You might have Clipsal out at Taylor Bend, and you might have the Formula One back in Adelaide. Who knows? I do urge members to support, but particularly point one of the motion, mainly because, point two is kind of icing on the cake, but we have heard some, off the cuff comments about it, but I'd like a formal position. I think you go through the process. I think we say we want to be on record, and we are, of course, it needs to be said, not suggesting that we need to build up a case for it. It's not our job. Our job is only to say we want to express a desire that you look at it, just look at it for us and tell us yes or no. But now's the time, because there is this rumination that there is going to be a shift of the event. We've done it well, we did it better than anyone, and if we don't ask the question now, we'll never know. You know, as they say, from little things, big things grow, Acting Lord Mayor. So I urge members to support both parts of the motion, specifically point one in particular.
So members, Councillor Antic has indicated that he's willing to have this matter taken in part, so I'm going to put part one of 9.3. All those in favour? All those against? That's carried. And now part two of 9.3. All those in favour? All those against? Again, that's carried. Brings us to 9.4. Councillor Martin, your motion on notice in relation to Uber zones.
Acting Lord Mayor, I have withdrawn that item.
Oh, thank you. That item's been withdrawn. Councillor Clarahan, item 9.5, shelter and seating. in Victoria Square.
Yes, look, I'd like to move that administration investigates opportunities for the provision of non-fixed umbrellas and extra seating for the northern section of Victoria Square, Tandanyanga, to support activation, and brings a report back to council. And I seek a second.
Have a seconder in Councillor Mullany.
Right. Look, it breaks my heart to think that we have spent $30 million on stage one of Victoria Square, and yet we haven't really provided the amenity that's required for people to use the space. And that on a warm day, a very warm day, there just isn't sufficient, there isn't sufficient shade and protection for people who want to be out in the open. And one of the things, one of the issues is parents with other children in prams supervising children that run through our water fountain, through the water fountain or feature, and just being totally exposed to the sun. And I just don't think that's good enough. And people who, for example, might want to purchase food from a food truck can't find anywhere comfortable and to sit, and that all the shady spots are already taken up in the square. I think we can do better than that. And if we're talking about, you know, activating our laneways, activating our public spaces, we need to provide better basic comfort and amenity. And I think that a lot of people, even during spring and autumn, would take advantage of sitting out in the open and enjoying what's on offer in the square if there was more shade and seating. And I leave it at that.
Thank you, Councillor Graham. Councillor Mullany, a second. Did you wish to add anything to that? Does anyone else wish to speak to this? Can I put it? Councillor Wilkinson.
The problem with the northern end of the square is that there's no trees in it, from my point of view. It was designed to be to facilitate stage rigging and events and things like that. It's so focused on it being designed for events that there were no trees put there. That's the problem. The reservation that I've got, I'm not sure other councils are going to support this, but is that the core issue is that there's no trees to provide shade there. And we have food trucks there, but most food trucks don't have chairs and umbrellas and things provided as well by the ratepayers. I think there's also commercial considerations. We're going to be also providing these sort of facilities for a business operating for $2,500 a year, you know, competing against other businesses on the edge of the square who have to pay for their rent most, and then they've got to pay for their outdoor dining. We're going to then provide this for free on top of a very generous base lease. I'd rather see us looking at planting large trees and things in that part of the square, rather than putting tables and chairs to aid a food truck enterprise.
Councillor, I'm going to support this. What we have in Victoria Square is just a small aspect of the grand design that was put forward in the previous council about the redevelopment of Victoria Square. And we've sunk $28 to $30 million into the redevelopment. And I know that there's concerns about council doing the rest, but in the meantime, between now and the next strategic plan, I think we need to do something with that to enable more activation and just putting some simple shade and some shelter and some seating in there temporarily is better than not having anything aside from Splash Adelaide activation and some food trucks occasionally. I think it's upon us to do something a bit more. And I do hope that we'll be able to get commitment from state government to be able to co-invest in redeveloping the remainder of Victoria Square, because it could be so much more. If you have a look at the designs from the previous council about what our plan was to do with Victoria Square, it's really wonderful, and it is somewhat disappointing to see that it's incomplete, and we have no real intention at the moment beyond 2018.
No money
set aside to invest into that. So hopefully with state government funding, we can co-contribute on a major infrastructure project in the next term of council.
Thanks, Councillor Crevel. Anyone else wish to speak to this before I go back to Councillor Clarahan to sum up? Councillor Clarahan.
Yes. Look, I thank members for their comments, and I do acknowledge that this section of the square does not have shade from trees, and it was intended that it be an open and flexible space, which is one of the reasons why I asked for non-fixed umbrellas, so that we can continue to have a flexible space used for any number of events. And I thank Councillor Corbell for her very thoughtful comments. Until we move on to the next stage of the development of Victoria Square, there isn't going to be a lot of shade, but it will be wonderful once we do complete the design, because it did take into account all of those amenity aspects. At the moment, it's just not getting there, and we need to be more thoughtful and customer focused.
Thank you, Councillor Clarahan. Can I put item 9.5, all those in favour? All those against? That's carried. Brings us to item 9.6, which is also one of yours, Councillor Clarahan.
Thank you, Acting Lord Mayor. I move that administration reports back to Council on opportunities to provide fast charging, plug-in and wireless charging stations for tablets, smartphones and laptops in public places, including squares, pedestrian precincts, the North Terrace Cultural Boulevard and Rundle Mall, and two, council liaise with the state government to investigate opportunities for placement of fast charging, plug-in and wireless charging stations at bus stops and railway stations across the CBD and North Adelaide. And I seek a seconder.
And you have one in, Councillor Martin.
Thank you. Look, in my travels in the US last year, I did note that in many of the parks and public places that people had their devices, their smartphones, tablets, iPads, etc., out working in parklands, on beaches, etc. And I was amazed at how cold it was in New York, and yet the place was absolutely packed with people who were plugged in and connected. And I thought, given our strategic drivers of having a livable city, a smart city, a green city, and of course a creative city, that really this opportunity ticked all the boxes. And given, I thought also over the last few weeks, given how busy people have been and the amount of time they've been out and about, enjoying all the wonderful things the city's had to offer, how easy it is for us to become, you know, for our devices to become drained and flat. And whereas if we had some stations where people could just plug in and recharge, that would mean that they stayed connected. They could check bus timetables. They could call a cab. They could see what's on in Adelaide. They could book a show. They could arrange to go and see to a sporting venue. They could actually let their friends and family know where they are and what they're up to. Or they could even arrange to meet with them somewhere else in the city. And so for a whole lot of reasons, I think we can provide some extra city infrastructure. Our infrastructure is not just about, you know, the basic roads, rates, rubbish, etc. We need recharge points as well. And of course, I know also that there's a move for the wireless connections. People with Android devices
are able to charge really easily with so-called wireless charging stations. They're not really. I mean, they do require a plug-in and they do require power. I mean, I know that lots of the McDonald's, for example, Starbucks provided these services to their customers. I also know that IKEA sells charging stations for people for their Android devices. And I think, you know, we want to be a smart city. We're undertaking pilot programs, but I think one of the most basic things we can do, along with providing free Wi-Fi, is to ensure that people can stay connected and charged up. I do also acknowledge that technology is changing rapidly. However, I think there's still time for us to provide some pretty basic recharging stations, and I see that as basic infrastructure for the city.
Thank you, Councillor Graham. Councillor Martin, then Councillor Corbell.
Yeah, look, I'll just be very brief, Acting Lord Mayor. Good on Councillor Clarahan. This proposal makes absolute sense. In cities all over the world, there are charging stations in transport hubs and public places generally. It's especially relevant here as we move to the kind of technology in which we will encourage visitors to navigate Adelaide by handheld device, whether that's a phone or a tablet, and consistent with a city that encourages students who use our Wi-Fi network, who one can see every day in public places using their tablets. As a place that aspires to be a smart city, this meets entirely our strategic plan, and therefore I'd urge all members to support it.
Councillor Corbell.
Thank you. I think this fits really well with the functions of the council according to the Local Government Act 1999. Noting that the functions of council are to provide services and facilities that benefit its area, its ratepayers, the residents, visitors, the area, including the general public services like pure roads, rates and rubbish, but also health, welfare, community services that benefit cultural and recreational services and facilities for the community. And this is something which is essential. The smartphone, really, for most of us globally, is an essential part of our daily lives. And to not provide recharge stations and points where people can access power to recharge their devices, to me, is a lack of provision for essential infrastructure. So I think it's good for us to explore putting a couple of points in.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak to this item before I hand back to Councillor Graham? Councillor Graham, to sum up?
Summed up.
Thank you. Can I put that, all those in favour of item 9.6? That's carried. 9.7, Councillor Slammer, Union Street Outdoor Dining.
Move as printed and seek a seconder.
Seconded, Councillor Moran.
Yeah, thank you, Councillor. Look, thank you to those councillors who came around this morning. I made a point of introducing as many councillors to the scenario as possible, so you know what's going on down there. And I want to make a point that this is merely a provisional scenario for the parking lot immediately at the front of Penny University on Union Street. This will allow up to four or five tables to go out on the curb. Without council spending a great deal of money. And yes, it does set a little bit of a precedent, because I don't think we've done this sort of thing before, but I think it's a compliment to the administration to show that we are able to react to these sort of opportunities in a quick way and test the waters before spending capital money on this sort of fence. I want to bring to the attention why I bought it and why this is a temporary activation per se. It's because, as you read in point two, 2017-18 is the budget year, the year of design to be built in 18-19, and these sort of things take a couple of years in this council to come off. Now, for a long time, we've reacted to the ratepayers who own multiple properties around this city, maybe the billion-dollar ratepayers or the billion-dollar businesses that occupy places next door, the multi-million-dollar landlords that own other parts of the precinct. This shows a commitment to the smaller landlord that might just own one building, in this case is an owner-occupier. And that is a critical point. He's an owner-occupier that owns the building on the corner of Rundle Street and Union Street. He operates a cafe at the front, and yet it's taken a long time to get any traction, to get some sort of activation happening out the front. So I can commend administration to this particular piece, and I recommend it to members for support.
Thank you, Councillor Sharma. Councillor Moran has seconded.
I'll reserve my right.
Anyone else wish to speak to this item? Councillor Antic and then Councillor Martin.
Just a question and clarification. I think it says in the report that there'll be no net loss to vehicle, and there's no car parking lost at all, is my understanding.
Angela, thanks.
Through you, Acting Lord Mayor, that's correct, there's no loss.
Thank you.
Councillor Martin.
Thank you, Acting Lord Mayor. Look, I did go down there with Councillor Slama this morning and had a look at what he was proposing. And yes, I support it. It's a great initiative for a small business in the area. However, as much as I support this, I would hate for this to be seen as a precedent for businesses all over town. There will be a cost, albeit minimal, of $2,000 to $3,000, but I just note that if there were 20 or 30 businesses who asked for the same thing, it would be a costly enterprise. But I support the principle, I support the small business initiative, and I will vote for it.
Just a question. If we support this tonight, does that mean it bumps some other work program off the agenda or any particular project?
You're talking to
paragraph 3, Councillor
Farahan?
Yes.
Yep.
Angela, thanks.
Through you, Acting Lord Mayor. We would be able to deliver this within our business as usual. It's a relatively small project, so I wouldn't see that we would need to bump anything else off the list.
Okay.
I think Councillor Clarahan's referring to paragraph 3 though, Angela, which relates to the design of an upgrade of Union Street during the 2017-18 year and the construct the following year, and whether Union Street was already sort of in the mix for a design at that year, and is anybody else being bumped?
Through you, Acting Lord Mayor, that project was already in the mix, but will certainly be coming to Council for its consideration as part of the 17-18 Integrated Business Plan. So it was already planned to come through as the project, planning 1 year, implementation the next.
Okay. So given that comment then, and given administration's comment, we could look at temporary measures prior to that coming before us as part of the budget bids. I'm very happy to support that.
Anyone, Councillor Wilkinson, Councillor Malani?
I thank Councillor Slama for bringing forward this motion, and just noting when we were discussing about Union Street and the limitation on parking and stuff previously, Councillor Antic's motion, I note in the report that what is being bumped, which I'm pleased to see being bumped, is the on-street bicycle parking right out the front of Gladys Simchains. And I know the owner of Gladys Simchains said to me, I'd rather have a car park there than this bicycle parking on the road. And then the report says that the bicycle parking has been relocated onto the footpath, which is where it should be in the first place. So I'm pleased to see that that's actually a side sort of repercussion of Councillor Slammer's motion. Thank you for that. That's a more sensible approach to doing bicycle construction when it doesn't preclude other modes of transport needlessly. So that's good. And and I'm pleased to see a little business like this. I was too busy with my own small business to make it this one. be giving a bit of a help with this initiative. Cheers.
Thanks, Councillor Wilkinson.
Thank you. I'm curious to know why, I haven't quite understood why this is temporary and why aren't we. What?
Yeah, because there's got to be a longer term plan to do a design for the whole street and to do some work in the street, design next year and do some work in the street after.
Yeah.
So what we're doing is just.
And that's why I guess. One of the things I'd like to see come out of this is we want planter boxes on O'Connell Street, and there's so many places. I'd like us to see how this works, and really look at where we can do similar scenarios in other parts of the city. Because there are so many streets crying out for this kind of design layout in a lot of quicker, cheaper style. So I would like to hope that this, you know, does set some precedents, and maybe it doesn't have to be so temporary. Maybe it works.
Thanks, Councillor Maloney. Anyone else before I go back to Councillor Slama to sum up? Councillor Slama.
In summing up, can I just ask a question in my summing up? How long would it take to activate, if this got up today, how long would it take to get temporary scenario on the street?
Through you, Acting Lord Mayor, it would be extremely quick. If we're reusing the planter boxes that are currently being used in Bank Street, I believe they're being removed next week, so we would look to relocate them as quickly as possible.
Great, thank you. I think that'd be a great outcome to the ratepayer there. And I'll sum up, I'll just mention, just off Councillor Antic's comment, I think there's a slight net an extra car park being created, or extra motorcycle park or two being created in this.
Thank you, Councillor Slama. Can I put that 9.7, all those in favour? That's carried. Thanks, members. Now I've lost my bit of paper. I scribbled all over it. Here we go. We're up to 9.8. Councillor Corbell, review of Adelaide City Council policies, policy monitoring and implementation processes.
Thank you. I seek a seconder for my motion.
Councillor Moran.
Thank you. Look, I'm really pleased that Councillor Moran seconded it because it's coincidental that on-street parking has come up today in addition to my motion. And in fact, I didn't realise, I thought that there was a motion on the books about on-street parking. Our existing on-street parking policy document and guidelines was put in place in 2001. And in fact, the opening introduction refers to 1998 parking policy and the City of Adelaide plan 1991 to 1996. So what I'm trying to achieve, that's just one example, what I'm trying to achieve with this motion is to bring about a review of council policy documents which are out of date. And this is exactly one example, just one example among many, which I've pointed out in point two, of council policy documents which are applicable now, they are current documents that our administration are using, and they are guidelines and strategies and bylaws and management plans and so on, which are not necessarily current. They're current, but they're out of date, so they're due for review. And some of them don't even have review dates in them. So our existing on-street parking policy doesn't actually have a review date in it. What I'm hoping to achieve is for us as an elected body to be able to see when the administration will be bringing forward policy documents for our review, so that it's clearly articulated and it's transparent for us as an elected body, but in addition to that, it's transparent to our ratepayers, so they can see council will be reviewing in November, as an example, the on-street parking policy. And then it gives everybody opportunity and time to ask questions, to provide input, to make contact with the administration, to put forward their ideas about what should or shouldn't be included in these policy documents. I think it's upon us as an elected body to make sure that we are open, we are transparent, and we have a process of accountability for our policy documents, and that's what I'm trying to achieve by bringing it forward for a workshop and highlighting a starting place, which is policy documents that were last reviewed or created more than five years ago, from 2010, so the previous term of council. And some of these date back to 2001, 2007, 2005. And in particular, the council policy framework document itself, which is the governing policy that oversees all of our policy making processes, is from 2009. So I seek your support in this, and I'm happy to take on board any of your ideas about possible variations.
Thanks, Councillor Corbell. Councillor Moran?
Yes, I think this is a very sensible motion. We need to modernise a lot of them as we keep tripping over old policies and old strategies. So I commend this motion to you.
Thank you. Councillor Maloney?
Thank you. I'll support this. I just wanted to ask a quick question. This to me is business as usual. This shouldn't even need a motion. But through the chair to Claire Mockler, the policy framework, didn't we do, I know 2014 we removed about 200 policies. We had this whole red tape clear out. But didn't we also at that point create a framework in which we were reviewing our policies? And that was definitely not 2009, it was post that. Don't we have something more recent? Or am I?
Through the presiding member, that is correct. However, the policy remained as is. It still felt relevant to meet council's needs at the time in terms of templates and structures. And
so it was reviewed since 2009, the council policy framework. So technically, it's not 2009, is it? Or just because we didn't change anything, isn't it more recent?
But it wasn't endorsed by council, so the review was undertaken. It was felt it was relevant for our current needs at that point in time. However, it's not formally brought into the chamber for council to endorse, hence it didn't get a new revision date on the front cover.
Right, a bit of process there. But I guess I'm all for reviewing policy, but we did throw out 200 plus policies a couple of years ago because we undertook this process. So I guess what I'm looking for here is not just having a motion that picks out 10, it's something a little bit more robust that says, hey, this is what we do all the time. And I'd be keen to not, I'm not going to do anything tonight with it, but that is what I would hope to see in the future.
I think that can just be taken on board because I think the Councillor Corbell's motion is wide enough, including but not limited to. So I think it's wide enough to capture exactly that, and I endorse your remarks, Councillor Mullen. Anyone else wish to speak to this? Back to you then, Councillor Corbell, to sum up.
Thank you. Yeah, my intent certainly is to have a more formal and clearly articulated process of review. So starting with the council policy document about our council policy framework, we're not actually adhering to it. So we've got a process in there, but to me it doesn't seem as though we're following our own policy documents. And so that comes back to an issue of accountability. And I think part of the issue is that maybe we don't have an implementation plan. I can't point to a document that says these are the policy documents that we will be reviewing and this is when we'll be doing it, then this is when they're due for review. And this is just council policy, not including administration policy, which is a whole separate issue altogether, internal administration policy documents. I'm just addressing the ones related to the public. So I do hope to bring about some improvements and improve accountability and transparency for this council and for the public.
Thank you, Councillor Corbell. Can I put 9.8, all those in favour? That's carried. Thanks very much. Members, that brings us to motions without notice. Do we have any? No. Then to item 11, which is exclusions of the public. So we've got, we've got four exclusions for the public because of the emerging risk item that our CEO foreshadowed a while back. So I need a mover for 12.1.1, moved by Councillor Mullany and seconded by Councillor Slammer. Do I do them one at a time? So can I put that for all those in favour? All those against? That's carried. Item 12.2.1, streetscape proposal. I need a mover for going into confidence. Moved by Councillor Mullany, seconded by Councillor Slammer. Can I put that? All those in favour? No, I beg your pardon?
No, look.
Jumping ahead.
Acting Lord Mayor, I'd like to argue against this matter being heard in confidence.
Just one moment. So we've got a mover and a seconder. So I'm going to ask the mover and the seconder if they want to speak to it first, and then I'll come to you, Councillor.
Sure.
I suspect they'll reserve their right, but let's just see. So Councillor Mullany, item 12.2.1, streetscape proposal.
Yes. Look, I would like to. Oh, sorry.
Do you wish to speak to it or reserve your right?
I'm just reading fine print.
It's just the exclusion we're talking to here?
Yeah.
Yep.
Public interest. Oh, is that my right?
Councillor Simon, do you wish to speak to it, or would you like to reserve your right? So, Councillor Martin, to you.
Okay, look, that's fine. This is a matter concerning the use of public property in a manner that will be at variance with council policy and practice. That alone means it's important to have this discussion in public and not behind closed doors. And secondly, this matter has previously been discussed in public in committee by these elected members. It has previously been discussed in public. There is no discernible difference in what is in here to what was discussed at committee. And I don't believe that it's possible to argue that there's any reasonable grounds, including commercial confidentiality. Now, the issue of commercial confidentiality arises because a matter has been attached to it that is commercial in confidence, which has absolutely no bearing on the proposal before us. There is no association. It is just in there. And as a consequence of that, this is being ruled as a motion that should be heard in confidence. And I disagree entirely with that.
Thank you very much, Councillor Martin. So, administration would like to comment, and then I've got Councillor Moran and Councillor Wilkinson.
Through you, Deputy Lord Mayor. It is clear the comments of Councillor Martin. I understand where he's coming from, but all I'm doing is responding to a requirement or a request from the applicant that they have included confidentially sensitive information, and they have requested that Council respect that. If Council does not wish to do that, I can respond to them in that to that effect. They can withdraw that component of the information and I can resubmit next Council meeting. It is entirely Council's decision. That is the reason behind it, and it's up to you as a Council to respond.
Well, I'll move that, if I may, Acting Lord Mayor, that the matter be deferred until the next meeting of Council.
No, you have to say that you should
defer
to go back to the applicant to
resubmit. Okay.
The council won't deal with it in
conference
because it involves a public. So they
have to resubmit. Okay,
yep.
So
what Councillor Moran said.
Have we got that administration? Just one moment and then we'll get a seconder. It's coming up on the screen, we're just waiting for it to come up.
Sure.
Councillor Moran, you've indicated that you'll support the deferral motion once we've got it.
Yep. You don't have to talk to the proceeding.
No. Yes, I'm happy with that, Acting Lord Mayor.
Thank you. Can I just check with the administration if that meets your requirements, administration?
Through you, Deputy Lord Mayor, yes, that's fine.
Okay. So, Councillor Moran, you're also happy with it as so to you in relation to the amendment? It
doesn't require any further embellishment.
Councillor Moran, do you wish to speak to it?
I think it's self-evident.
Anybody else wish to speak to the amendment? I'll put it. All those in favour? All those against? That's carried. That becomes a substantive motion. Can I put that as a substantive motion? All those in favour? All those against? That's carried. Thanks very much, members. Okay, that brings us to items 12.2.2, Capital City Committee update, moved by Councillor Malani, seconded by Councillor Wilkinson. Can I put that? All those in favour? That's carried. And item 12.2.3, which is the foreshadowed motion, which is called Emerging Risk Temporary Infrastructure Proposal. And that's been put to us on the basis of commercial in confidence, the category, and that's up on the screen as well. So has someone happy to move that? Councillor Malani, seconded by Councillor Sama. Can I put that? All those in favour? That's carried. Thank you. So can all members of the gallery and any staff member not directly associated with the upcoming confidential matters, please leave the chamber. Thank you.
Thank you, members. I'll now formally close the meeting.
Where's dinner?
Who knows?
I don't know.
I'm not sure. I think the members were there. Well, you know, we'll just have to smoke.
We're just sending everyone upstairs 3 o'clock.